Week is recognized by several organizations nationally for its importance as economic challenges continue at a national level. And whereas Minority Enterprise Development Week of Western North Carolina Incorporated has provided training and a week-long celebration of minority-owned businesses for the past 31 years. And whereas local observance of Minority Enterprise Development Week will be the week of September 14th through 18th, 2015. Now, therefore, we, Esther Mannheimer, Mayor of the City of Asheville, and David Gant, Chairman of the Board of Commissioners for Buncombe County, do hereby proclaim the week of September 14th through 18th, 2015, as Minority Enterprise Development Week in the City of Asheville and the County of Buncombe, and urge all citizens to join together with the minority business enterprises of our community in appropriate observances.
Congratulations.
Thank you. We're very pleased to be here. I'm Sharon Oxendine. I'm the vice chair of MedWeek, or the board of MedWeek. I thank each one of you and the mayor for this time today and the proclamation. Since 1982, President Reagan recognized MedWeek, and since 1983, the Western North Carolina has been supporting this initiative also. I'm very proud to be a part of this board. It includes Jane Hatley. We are a very diverse face that represents this community. We're really glad to be here, and this is actually our 32nd year. So with the support from the city, from the county, and from many people here in the community, we are able to present events all week long and end up with an awards banquet. And Jane's going to tell us a little bit about the awards.
Hi, I feel like Vanna White. I'm Jane Hatley with Self Help Credit Union, and I'm also on the board of MedWeek. And we have a bunch of events this year. On Tuesday, there's a Meet Your Lender event at Mountain Biz Works in the morning. And on Tuesday in the evening is a new event, which is a networking event for minority-owned businesses. And it's going to be held at the Center for Creativity, Craft, and Design from 4 to 6 with former MedWeek Award winners as the panelists, and also the folks from Color of Asheville and Date Your City will be there. So we hope to get a lot of folks involved in getting to know each other as well. On Wednesday morning, there's a special class for contracting with government agencies for small business. There's also a business marketing class with Sheila Niesler at Mountain Biz Works. And Thursday night is the annual awards event, so I hope you all can come. Thank you so much for the proclamation. We really appreciate it.
The next item on the agenda is a proclamation declaring Day of Peace, and Councilmember Cecil Bothwell will read this proclamation, and I understand that Rachel Bliss maybe here, and others at all.
Whereas the ideal of peace embraces the deepest hopes of all people and remains humanity's guiding inspiration, and whereas in 1981, the United Nations proclaimed the International Day of Peace be devoted to commemorating and strengthening the ideals of peace both within and among all nations and peoples, and whereas the United Nations expanded the observance of the International Day of Peace in 2001 to include the call for a day of global ceasefire and nonviolence, and invited all nations and people to honor a cessation of hostilities for the duration of the day, and whereas it is fitting and proper to support the observance of the International Day of Peace, which affirms a vision of our hearts and our world at peace and fosters cooperation between individuals, organizations, and nations, and whereas global crises compel all citizens to work toward converting humanity's noblest aspirations for world peace into a practical reality for future generations, and whereas in Asheville, the following groups and organizations work to promote peace and justice in our communities: the Asheville-Buncombe Community Relations Council, Swannanoa Valley PAX, Christie USA, Veterans for Peace Chapter 99, Servanthood House, Center for Spiritual Living, Asheville, French Broad Food Co-op, Physicians for Social Responsibility, First Congregational United Church of Christ, Mountain People's Assembly, North Carolina Peace Action, Blue Ridge Pride Center, Ethical Humanist Society of Asheville, Just Peace for Israel-Palestine, Creative Peacemakers, the Episcopal Diocese of Western North Carolina, Returned Peace Corps Volunteers of Western North Carolina, Asheville White Dove Releases, Sacred Circle of Asheville, Parish of St. Eugene, Peace is Possible, Healing Love Institute, St. Margaret Mary Catholic Church, HeartSpeak, Asheville Friends Meeting of the Religious Society of Friends, the Quakers, Transition Asheville, Brooks Howell Residence, the Baha'i Community, Elders Fierce for Justice, Episcopal Peace Fellowship of WNC, Ash Village, North Carolina Green Party, the Cathedral of All Souls, Jubilee Community, the School of Peace, WNC for Peace, Mama and Papa Bear's Peace Garden, Fellowship of Reconciliation, and the Western North Carolina Physicians for Social Responsibility. Now, therefore, I, Esther E. Manheimer, Mayor of the City of Asheville, do hereby proclaim September 21st, 2015, as a day of peace in the City of Asheville, and call upon the people of Asheville to observe this day in our community as we imagine, build, cultivate, expect, and celebrate peace on earth.
Thank you for doing this proclamation for us. It means a lot to us. I invite all of you to many days of peace this year. We will be celebrating on Thursday, beginning at the Center for Spiritual Living with a Labyrinth Walk. And then on Sunday, we'll have a big peace festival down at the lot by the food co-op. And then on Monday, we'll be right outside the City Hall here at the Peace Pole, and we'll be observing the day, as Mr. Bothwell talked about. We'll also be ringing the bells right in this very building at 12 noon on September 21st. I urge everybody near a bell to ring it on that day. And I'd also like to tell you that on our Sunday event, if we're lucky, we are giving an award to Reverend William Barber for his work as Peacemaker of the Year, and we hope he can come by and accept his award. For now, I'd like to introduce Celeste, who would tell you more about a small goal or big goal we have for upcoming peace efforts in our city.
Good evening, council members. Adlai Stevenson, ambassador to the United Nations in 1961, said the journey of 1,000 leagues begins with a single step, so we must never neglect any work of peace within our reach, however small. We may seem like a small group, but we are a committed group of people from many different local group organizations supporting peace. We have an individual focus, but also we come together because we believe peace is possible. Peace is not just a hope, but it is a right for every individual. Our desire and intention is to have Asheville add to its many accolades a city of peace, known as an international city of peace and compassion, and to join the hundreds of other cities and communities around the world who already have identified themselves as such. To do so, we know we must foster peace as a consensus value and work together to collaborate with all individual organizations in our community. It is our intention to do this, and we know it is a process that will take time. It's also something that, while we really honor and acknowledge the International Day of Peace, we honor that every day may become a day of peace, and that is our ultimate goal, as I'm sure that everyone shares that value. So we believe that a compassionate world is a peaceful world, and that treating each other as we want to be treated is a way that we all begin. Thank you for this opportunity.
I would like to ask all who came to celebrate this proclamation to please stand up.
Okay, so for our next item, we have something not on the printed agenda. That is just a special little surprise. And it's right there. And I'm going to ask Jan to do this because he knows more about it, the most about it. But we wanted to surprise our city manager because he loves surprises. With a
look at that face.
Look how much he loves surprises. Of a picture of him, our own city manager, who some of you may or might not know, is a major bicycle enthusiast, and Jan Davis will take it from here.
Come on down here. Who cares? He does not. The real reason I got this is I won't be here too long for him to bother me with it, but we found out that And those of you who know Gary know him well knows that he's an avid bicyclist, and he's also one who doesn't like a lot of praise, not a lot of fanfare. That comes from being city manager. They don't like to fly too high above the radar. But this we found out about, and this is huge. Go ahead and turn it around. This is too cool. Gary. Gary won his class in the Grand Fondo, I guess it was the week before last. And for those of you who don't know what a Grand Fondo is, that's a bicycle race that has different lengths. And Gary, I think that was a 60-mile race. He won his category, his age group, which is a pretty large age group. I won't say what they call that category, but anyhow. We wanted you to have this because we know that you're not the type of person that would have this this picture be taken of you and put in public, but because this council asked that you put it up somewhere, we appreciate it in the building, but if not, not in the closet, but your den or somewhere in this building would be very appropriate. Council wanted to recognize you for such a great accomplishment.
Yeah.
So that was way better than the bobblehead that Kathy gave you, wasn't it? All right, next. On our consent agenda, we need to pull item H to be heard on October 13th. Do we need a motion to do that, or we're just noting it? Okay, we're just noting that we're moving it to item H, October 13th. Are there any questions, comments, or a motion regarding the rest of the consent agenda? I would quickly explain that item J, which is a motion to refer the amendment to the Unified Development Ordinance regarding homestays to the City Council Planning and Economic Development Committee, is administrative in nature. I think it became necessary housekeeping to make sure we had a formal motion to refer that matter to PED, which is what we discussed at our last meeting.
Mayor, I'd just like to note on consent item C, this is consideration of a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a contract. This is for sidewalks on Hendersonville Road. Mm-hmm. This has been a long time coming, folks, and we've got over 2.5 miles of new sidewalks going in an area that's rapidly developing, and I appreciate all the work of staff to get us to this place here, and this is to let the contract make the work begin. Mm-hmm.
On item I, the resolution to support redistricting reform. So what are we going to do with that resolution? Are we going to forward that to?
We can make that available to the folks that are lobbying the legislature for redistricting reform. And I believe it's Richard Vinroot and a former governor,
Charles Meeker.
Oh, Meeker. Okay. Who have are putting together this coalition of different cities and counties that are advocating for, and other entities that are advocating for redistricting reform.
Great. Well, I clearly support it and hope we are successful.
Any other questions, comments, or a motion which should exclude item H?
I make a motion to accept the consent agenda excluding item H.
All right, anyone wishing to comment on the motion to approve the consent agenda? We have Boy Scouts here now, maybe they want to. No, okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right, under presentations and reports, we were to see a presentation of simplicity, but it is not working, so we will see it on October 13th. Not that simple. And then item B is the legislative update, which I normally provide, and there's really not much to update other than the fact that the legislature is still in session and still hammering out the budget. And that's kind of all they're doing right now is budget work. And Councilmember Bothwell and I were talking earlier today about a provision that would make it difficult to construct bike lanes, and we are watching that. Other cities are very concerned about those provisions as well, which are has been explained to me as a provision that would shift the cost of such infrastructure to cities to shoulder, even where it's a DOT project. Anyone have anything else they want to add to the legislative update? All right. So when Representative McGrady joked about Halloween costumes, I'm pretty sure he wasn't kidding. But they may be there till Halloween. All right, so that does it for presentations. We are on to our public hearings agenda. The first item under the public hearings agenda is a public hearing to consider adoption of the Historic Preservation Master Plan as part of the Asheville City Development Plan to 2025. Stacey Merton is here to make the presentation. I know I saw your chair come in. The Historic Resource Commission was kind enough to let me participate in their annual retreat this year, and we did that this last week and talked about this master plan, so I'm excited to see the presentation tonight.
Thank you, Mayor Manheimer, members of City Council. My name is Stacey Merton. I'm the Director of Historic Resources, and I am pleased to be here this evening to present to you the final draft of the Historic Preservation Plan for Asheville and Buncombe County. I actually did have a slideshow prepared, which I guess I'm not able to share, so I'll just be able to talk about it tonight. So I did want to share just a few items about historic preservation, given this opportunity. And the first thing I wanted to share is that preservation is not just about preserving old buildings and aesthetics, but it actually provides continuity, which is important for livability. Old places create a sense of continuity that helps people feel more balanced, stable, and healthy. But continuity is not about the past only. It is also about the present and the future. That's what continuity means, bringing the relevance of the past to give meaning to the present and the future. Historic preservation is also about placemaking. Historic preservation contributes to placemaking through identification, evaluation, and conservation of the built environment. And it's an essential element to authentic placemaking. A community's physical form, rather than its land uses, is the most intrinsic and enduring quality of a place. Preservation is also about sustainability. The National Trust Preservation Green Lab report, The Greenest Building, found that in almost every case, the reuse of existing buildings results in fewer environmental impacts over their lifespan compared to the demolition and new construction. And then there's a new report out by the National Trust Preservation Green Lab. It's called Older, Smaller, and Better, and I think it's really relevant for Asheville. And it's they've studied other cities in San Francisco and Seattle, to name a few, and actually found that the creative economy thrives in older, mixed-use neighborhoods, that older, smaller buildings provide space for a strong local economy, that older mixed-use neighborhoods are more walkable, and that older business districts provide affordable, flexible space for entrepreneurs from all backgrounds. So those are things that I think we all knew sort of intuitively, but research is now proving that to be true. Also, preservation creates jobs, increases property values in the tax base, uses existing public infrastructure, saving money for the city in that way, and it also attracts heritage tourism. So why plan? Planning has a number of benefits. Specifically, it provides a clear focus and direction for our preservation work. It promotes quality urban design that reflects Asheville's architectural legacy. It outlines strategies for neighborhoods and small area planning efforts. And an adopted plan is a tool for local governments to further partnerships and pursue funding opportunities. And so the preservation plan that we prepared actually did not cost the taxpayers any money. We were able to get a grant through the State Historic Preservation Office, and then in partnership with the Preservation Society of Asheville and Buncombe County, raised the matching funds for that. So we did that work, and then we hired a consultant to help us with the process. We've been working on the plan for close to 2 years, kind of a culmination of a two-year process, involved quite a bit of public engagement. The consultant formed, or actually the HRC formed an advisory committee to work with the consultant. There were a number of public meetings. There were specific focus groups. And then, of course, we worked with staff from the various city departments that would be impacted. And then also in the past year, really have been taking it through the Historic Resources Commission, the Planning and Zoning Commission, the Downtown Commission, and the Planning and Economic Development Subcommittee of City Council. The plan is basically divided into 8 chapters, kind of touching on the various aspects of preservation, public outreach being an important component of that. But we also talk about downtown and business districts. There's a specific chapter on Buncombe County, and a specific chapter on heritage tourism, as well as neighborhoods. And my favorite part of the plan is the implementation matrix, because that really is where the rubber meets the road, and I'm looking forward to implementing the plan as we move forward. This plan is in compliance with Asheville's City Development Plan 2025 for a number of reasons. I'm actually not going to read them. I'll just read a couple of them. Thanks, Alan. Preservation does help protect downtown's wealth of historic buildings, promotes high quality design and new construction. These are specific elements that were in our 2025 plan. Encourages the identification, evaluation, and documentation of historic resources and others. And I think most importantly, helps to strengthen a strong positive identity and sense of place for all. So for all of these reasons, I am recommending that the City Council adopt the Historic Preservation Plan as part of the Master Plan for Asheville and Buncombe County for City Development 2025. And then I anticipate that the plan would then become a part of the new comprehensive plan as we go forward. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I have a question. I noticed in the one section about strategies for strengthening downtown design review, I wondered if in the course of putting this together, you talked about the idea that we now have mandatory review and voluntary cooperation or voluntary implementation, and whether it might not help to go to mandatory use of the review.
Right. We did talk about that quite extensively. I would say that that was probably the most heated discussion as part of the plan process, as far as where there was some disagreement on whether we should try to make downtown a local district or not. Ultimately, the advisory committee didn't think it was the most appropriate thing to do, but they did support a number of strategies to strengthen the downtown review process and bring it more in alignment with preservation goals. So you will see if in chapter 6 specifically, right. So those were the ways that the committee felt could strengthen the process without going completely to a full-blown local district. Also, there's a possibility that we could do smaller conservation districts, which we still, I believe, can do even with some of the changes in the state legislature. In commercial areas where we could identify very important characteristics of smaller areas and have a more of a mandatory process for those items. So there is another tool that's available besides a full-blown local district.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I was calling in with one.
Let's see what this person's question is. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item on our public hearings agenda. Oh, so there wasn't anything to vote on with that item. There is a resolution. So do we need to open the public hearing on the, all right. So I'm going to open the public hearing on the consideration of the adoption of the Historic Preservation Master Plan as a part of the Asheville City Development Plan 2025. So if there's anyone wishing to speak on this item, yes.
I'm Dave Nutter, a resident of the Montford Historic District, a member of the Historic Resources Commission, although I'm here as an individual this evening, and a community planner with experience in historic preservation and adaptive reuse for over half a century. We think that preservation is vital to the human success of our valley here. It is a mainstay of neighborhood, downtown, riverfront, and commercial area authenticity. To me, community character is an evolution of community history by past generations mixed with present citizens. You can feel it as you walk. You sense it in the daily spirit of the city. It breathes deeper meaning and memory of people long ago. To us, it means honoring local landmarks, preserving neighborhood districts, inspiriting downtown and the River Arts District, mixed use, adaptive reuse, and partnerships of the new and the bold with the old and the kept. It contributes to environmental and economic sustainability. It builds the reputation of the city for innovation. With the Preservation Society and other advocates of historic preservation, we at HRC privately raised the money to match the certified local government grant we received. We are grateful for city support from the Department of Planning and Urban Design, especially the good work of HRC Director Stacy Merton and leadership by our chairperson, Brendan Ross. We had great participation. The plan helps us guarantee the integration of preservation into the daily work of the city and to do it more thoroughly. It provides the public with a sense of the whole. It offers developers a chance to heighten the character of their projects. It will not overregulate. It helps encourage new directions, such as using historic buildings for affordable housing. It invites public-private partnership. The design reviews carried out by HRC are intended to ensure compatibility with historic character. Last week, we had our most successful commission retreat in memory with discussion of next steps in the future of preservation in the entire community. Both Mayor Manheimer and Buncombe County Chairman David Gant participated enthusiastically. We discussed community renaissance in terms of positive growth and sustainability and how best to fit it in with new projects. I believe we have a fine plan for 21st century preservation in this mountain valley and urge you to support it. Thank you.
Is there anyone else? We have this rule against clapping in here, but I can't squelch clapping for Dave Nutter. So, is there anyone else? Yes.
Mayor, City Council, my name is Jack Thompson. I'm the Executive Director of the Preservation Society of Asheville and Buncombe County. I appreciate the moment to remark today on this important event. Historic preservation is often mislabeled as the mission of no change, no to the new. Sometimes we're labeled the hysteric preservationists, when in fact, preservation is the movement of thoughtful, deliberate, and where's our new guy? Planned change. Deliberate planning established the Downtown National Register District, which in turn spurred the investment of millions of dollars for the historic rehabilitation, positioning our historic buildings to become the foundation of our current destination economy. This comprehensive plan, which is fully supported by the Preservation Society of Asheville and Buncombe County, will provide the framework and the next steps for preservation in our community, which I believe can integrate well with other important initiatives Mr. Nutter suggested, such as affordable housing, destination management, and energy sustainability. With that, the Preservation Society and our members hope that this plan can have your full support today, and a commitment along with PSABC and other partners mentioned in the plan for a focus on its implementation. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, anyone else? All right, I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion.
I move to adopt a resolution to accept the Historic Preservation Master Plan for Asheville and Buncombe County as part of the officially adopted comprehensive plan for the City of Asheville, and find that the request is reasonable in the public interest and is consistent with the Asheville City Development Plan 2025 in the following ways. One, the plan will encourage the protection of downtown's wealth of historic buildings. Two, a high-quality design in new construction projects. Three, the identification, evaluation, and documentation of Asheville's historic resources. Four, the continuation of efforts to preserve and manage change within historic districts. Five, the continuation of education towards preservation of Asheville's historic resources. And six, the strengthening of a strong, positive identity and sense of place for all.
Second.
All right, motion and second. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, the second item on our public hearing agenda is a resolution to permanently close an unnamed alley between Wyoming Road and Keebler Road, and Chad Bandy is here to tell us about it. You just have the one picture. Good, we're in luck.
Mayor Manheimer, members of council, thank you for allowing me the time to be here this evening. As you said, I'm here seeking a resolution for the permanent closure of a right-of-way, unopened, unnamed right-of-way between Keebler and Wyoming. The property owner adjacent to the right-of-way, Mr. Thomas Wolf, is with us this afternoon. His intentions, as I understand, are to allow infill development of this piece of property and to gain proper setbacks by closing this alley. Also, by closing this alley, we will not negatively impact any ingress and egress from this. As you can see from the map, all the properties will touch either Wyoming or Keebler, and no ingress, egress will be lost. Through that, I do not see any, or staff does not see any negative impacts, and we would recommend a resolution to permanently close this if possible. If you have any questions, I would be happy to answer those at this time.
Questions? Okay, thank you. I will open the public hearing on this item B. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? All right, I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion.
Mayor, move to approve that we adopt the resolution to permanently close an unnamed alley between Wyoming and Keebler Roads.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. All right, item C1 and a C2, I assume, have to be heard separately. Item C1, a public hearing to consider rezoning 200 Ashland Avenue from Regional Business District to Central Business District, and Jessica Bernstein is here to tell us about it.
And I will present on both of these together since they are related. The project site consists of a single parcel, just under half an acre, located at 200 Ashland Avenue. You can see on the exhibit map with the aerial, currently on the site is a single-story office building with surface parking. The site is currently zoned regional business. This is just at the southern edge of the central district, and you can see CBD zoning to the north and east of the site, and there is regional business across Ashland Avenue to the west, as well as just immediately to the south. The applicant is proposing a straight rezoning to central business district. This proposal does not have any development associated with it. It's simply the change in zoning. This is, you've seen us up here regarding this before, this is the fifth request that we've had in this area in the last 2 years, and so I've detailed some of the other rezonings that have been approved. The project or the rezoning site is right here, regional business. In 2013, we rezoned a large piece here on Ashland Avenue up at Ashland and Hilliard at three sites. So you can see kind of the layout here. And as we've discussed when we've brought these requests in the last couple of years, staff is intending to pursue a multi-parcel corridor rezoning all along Ashland Avenue. Back in January 2014, staff met with property owners, and that went well. And then the next step is to meet with the neighbors that are the residential property owners and residents in this neighborhood. It's much simpler to simply rezone the east side of Ashland Avenue, since it's central business district adjacent. But when we're looking at rezoning these properties from office business and regional business, since they are next to single family zoning, we really want to take our time to do an analysis of each parcel to kind of come up with what could be the development potential. And we haven't gotten to that point yet, but are still fully intending to pursue that corridor rezoning. But in the meantime, when an individual request comes in, we take it through the process as we're doing now. So as was stated in the past, when we've had these requests come in, the Downtown Master Plan did anticipate this area for CBD expansion. The 2025 plan and other city policies do support expanding the CBD and the high-density, mixed-use, walkable development that could be promoted along Ashland Avenue. We previously approved extending the key pedestrian streets map along Ashland Avenue, so that's already been done. With this request is that amendment to the height zone map. The area around is all, here we go, I'm not gonna zoom in, I'll just point, right, where this is where we are right here, regional business to CBD. This is in the intermediate height zone, so that's what's being proposed for this parcel. The Downtown Commission did review this request at their meeting in July. It was unanimously recommended for support. Similarly, the Planning and Zoning Commission also recommended unanimous approval. Not received any public comment. So because this area is being targeted by the city for corridor rezoning, and because of the compliance with the various adopted plans and visions of the city, the staff does recommend approval of the rezoning to CBD, as well as the amendment to the height zone map to intermediate. That concludes my report, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Okay, we'll open the public hearing on item C1, the rezoning of 200 Ashland Avenue from Regional Business District to Central Business District. Is there anyone wishing to comment on this item C1? I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion.
I move to approve the zoning map amendment from Regional Business to Central Business District as a standard rezoning, including the amendments to the height zone map, and find that the request is reasonable and is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans based on information provided in the staff report as stated in the staff recommendation.
Second. All right, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, do I have a motion on,
inadvertently.
There's two moves.
Right, yeah, there was one motion, but that was a motion can be to do the rezoning. I think if you open the public hearing on a height map, then we can just do that part of it again.
Okay, so I'll open the public hearing on an ordinance amending the officially adopted height zone map, item C2. Anyone wishing to speak on this item? I will close the public hearing, and now for the motion.
So moved.
Okay.
Like last.
You want it read again?
Are you seconding? Whatever I need. Do you feel comfortable again saying ditto?
No.
Let's just read it.
Okay. I moved to approve the height zone, the amendment to the height zone map, and find that the request is reasonable and is consistent with a comprehensive plan and other adopted plans based on information provided in the staff report and as stated in the staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, item D. A public hearing to consider a modification to a conditional use permit for Biltmore Gardens, originally approved in 2005, now known as Commercial Properties at Biltmore, to include the development of the commercial portion of the project with 3 two-story office buildings and associated parking on property known as 700 Biltmore Avenue. Alan Glines, no longer interim director. No longer interim planning director.
Mayor, this is quasi-judicial, so you need to get everyone's...
All right, so anyone who thinks they even might be swayed to speak on this topic, on this item D, needs to come up here and see Maggie and be sworn in. Just even if you're in doubt, you know, you're on the fence about speaking.
Thank you, Mayor, members of City Council, members of the public. The development group Near Urban Development is requesting a modification of a conditional use permit to accommodate minor changes in an approved development plan. This plan, known originally as Biltmore Gardens, included 114 residential units and a commercial component. The residential units were closed out and completed, and it is the commercial component that is now the subject of this modification. This is the Exhibit A map for the development. This is Biltmore Avenue here, running this way. This is Caledonia Road, Bowling Park Road, and Kenilworth Place. A little more context is the Exhibit B map. This is the apartments, which were built probably 25, 30 years ago and renovated in this 2005 time period. And this is where the commercial development was approved in 2005 and where the modification would also apply to this area as well. Once again, this is Biltmore Avenue here, Caledonia Road. Those are the major access points for the site. This is the site plan that was approved by City Council in 2005. It's focusing just on the lower portions of this development site. This is Caledonia Road here, and this is Biltmore Avenue here, Kenilworth Place. There were to be four commercial structures. This was building number one, building two, and building three, and I'm in, up at the top here on the first level with the residential units, building four. The original permit would allow four structures totaling 5,060 square feet, one of which was proposed to be a restaurant space. In the plan today, which I'm focused on now, let's zoom in just a little bit here. Same orientation. Biltmore Avenue, Caledonia here. This is below the apartments. This is that shelf that's already been graded out. Building one, building two, and building three. The layout is very similar. I do need to make a correction in the report. There is a table that I showed the wrong dimension. The total proposed today would be 10,255 square feet. That's the total proposed, and that was provided by the applicant in their seven standards test, their study of the seven standards. I wanted to point out from the original approval, the building one is being reduced from 6,900 square feet to 3,700 square feet. Building two would be reduced from 4,800 square feet to 4,555 square feet. Building three would actually increase slightly to 1,970 square feet. Building four is completely eliminated. I'll provide that to Maggie for the record. So this is the site master plan and layout. This is the same plan with landscaping. There will be parking improvements made and landscaping around the buildings and the parking locations here. There's currently an access point here off of Bowling Park Road, an access point on Caledonia Road. There is an exit only proposed to be here at Kenilwood Place, and no direct access points to Biltmore Avenue. In the plan set, the development team provided some analysis for different scenarios. And I'm going to adjust this one more time. The plan in red shows the 2005 approvals, this area here, and the plan in green shows the proposals today. So they're very closely related to the locations that were originally approved. The next sheet kind of overlays them in the same way. Red is the 2005 plan, here, here, and here, and in green is the current proposal. So building number two is actually reduced in size. Building number one is reduced in size, and building number three is expanded slightly. That provides an interesting overview comparing those. The original character drawings provided a mix of residentially scaled commercial buildings that incorporated a variety of revival type of architecture, colonial, Italianate, sort of the English style. I'll just quickly go through those. This would be a view from Biltmore Avenue. This is interior village view, they call it. So it's kind of a recreation of a village kind of atmosphere inside the development area itself. These are the apartments which were renovated, and they pretty much look like that today. So they had some updates and upgrades to those facilities. And this was sort of a section through the whole site. This is Biltmore Avenue down below, and the commercial components here, and these are those existing residential units. Finally, one more. This is a sort of an axonometric from Biltmore Avenue, originally approved. So the proposal today is similar in that the architecture is residential in scale and detailing, slightly modified to be a little more contemporary. They have simple detailing, gable roofs with clip gables, dormers. There are other details with the use of trellis and stone, other hardy plank. For the project site itself. I'll just go through these buildings for you. This is building number one, building number two, and finally building number three. The project was reviewed by the technical review committee. There were minor comments in that report. I've included that in your materials for this hearing. I've also heard from a member of the Kenilworth Residents Association who was on their board. They took the item to a meeting of the Kenilworth Residents Association. There was not any major concerns from that group. I also received a letter of support from the Condo Association for the residents of Biltmore for the changes being proposed tonight. So I can answer any questions for you if you like. That concludes my presentation.
Any questions? Okay. We'll hear from the developer. Yes.
Mayor Manheimer, members of Asheville City Council, my name is Lou Bissett, and I'm representing Near Urban Development Company in its application for a modification to the conditional use permit for the project now known as the Residences at Biltmore Commercial Properties. I have with me tonight representatives of the developer, Joel Sowers, as well as the architect, Peter Alberies, and the land planner, Matt Sprouse from SiteWorks. They're all here to answer any questions that you might have during this hearing. As you're aware, the commercial components originally planned as a part of this mixed-use project and approved by the City Council in 2005 were never completed as a result of the economic downturn and the project's subsequent bankruptcy and foreclosure. The commercial properties were purchased earlier this year by my client, Near Urban Development Company, and Near Urban proposes to complete three commercial buildings basically as approved in the 2005 conditional use permit. As Alan indicated, one of the four commercial structures originally approved will not be constructed and is not a part of this application tonight. This modification seeks to reduce the overall amount of commercial space from approximately 15,000 square feet in 2005 to approximately 10,000 square feet today. And as I previously indicated, includes only three commercial structures. As Alan indicated, the size of one structure, building number 3, will be increased by a small amount of square footage, and the size of the other 2 structures will be reduced. And we believe that this reduction in both the size and overall impact of the already modest 2005 conditional use permit. Furthermore, the footprints, I think you can still see up there, and you can see them on pages 700 and 701 of our current proposal, indicate that these 3 buildings are in essentially the same location as previously approved by the council in 2005. Access, sidewalks, parking, landscaping, and open space remain as previously approved and meet the city's requirements as outlined in the UDO. As you are well aware, you are authorized to review and evaluate conditional use applications on the basis of the criteria set out in section 716.2 of the UDO, and further, you shall not approve the conditional use application site plan unless and until you make certain findings based on the evidence and testimony received at the public hearing or otherwise appearing in the record of this case. This time I would request that the application as submitted by the applicant to the city in this matter be entered into evidence for your consideration, as well as the staff report prepared by Alan Glines. I will briefly review the 7 conditional use permit standards with you, and I believe that our request meets all 7 of these standards. That the proposed use or development of the land will not materially endanger the public health or safety. Our proposed development is consistent with the previously approved conditional use permit and will adhere to the standards set by the city, state, and federal governments in protecting public health and safety. Number 2, that the proposed use or development of the land is reasonably compatible with significant natural and topographical features on the site and within the immediate vicinity of the site, given the proposed site design and any mitigation techniques or measures proposed by the applicant. As with the 2005 proposal, the current plan proposes 3 new buildings. Building 4 will not be built, as I indicated. The new building locations will continue to preserve the existing stand of trees at the front of the development, and the building locations are essentially the same as previously approved. Number 3, that the proposed use or development of the land will not substantially injure the value of adjoining or abutting property. As in the original plan, the project will still be an attractive mixed-use project. The commercial uses are still placed at the front of the development and oriented towards Biltmore Avenue. The existing green lawn space and the line of trees will remain as a vegetative screen. Number 4, that the proposed use of the development of the land will be in harmony with the bulk scale coverage density and character of the area or neighborhood in which it is located. As we've indicated, the proposed buildings still fit within the context of the neighborhood. The square footage has been reduced, as we indicated, and the one building that actually has a larger square footage actually will have a smaller footprint than it had initially. Number 5, that the proposed use or development of the land will generally conform with the comprehensive plan, smart growth policies, sustainable economic development, strategic plan, and other official plans adopted by the city. Here again, this is an infill project which will serve the neighborhood with its proposed uses of office and community amenity space with limited retail and food service. And it supports, of course, the city's multimodal transportation goals. Number 6, that the proposed use is appropriately located with respect to transportation facilities, water supply, fire and police protection, waste disposal, and similar facilities. This project is served by adequate police and fire protection, water and sewer infrastructure, street networks, existing sidewalks, and public transportation along Biltmore Avenue. Our plans will provide additional sidewalks and a bus shelter at Caledonia and Biltmore, which was a condition of the original conditional use permit. And finally, 7, that the proposed use will not cause undue traffic congestion or create a traffic hazard. This project did not warrant a traffic study in 2005 because of the square footage, and those threshold standards apply today. It is important to reiterate that this modified plan will generate less traffic than the 2005 approved plan. Additionally, a condition of the original conditional use permit required that a traffic light study be completed to determine if a light was warranted at the intersection of Caledonia and Biltmore. This study was completed by the Department of Transportation and indicated that a light was not warranted at this intersection. In closing, I believe that we've submitted, and I think Alan submitted that letter from the residents at Biltmore Condominium Owners Association, and there are 114 units represented in there, and their board has unanimously approved this concept plan and asked for your support and approval of the requested modification, and I think it's already been submitted, so I won't do that again. So thank you very much for your consideration. My clients and their representatives are here and are prepared to try to answer any of your questions. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Thank you.
All right, process-wise, Robin, we're not.
Are you going to have anyone testify on your behalf other than you, Mr. Bissett?
No.
Okay. I guess then you're finished with your case? Okay, I guess that you are going to admit what he's submitted for exhibits.
All right, we'll receive.
Here we go, and so now it's time for any opponents.
And I didn't see anyone else get sworn in, but is there anyone here to speak on this item that wants to speak in opposition to it that missed the opportunity to get sworn in first? Okay, no.
Okay, so at this time, council could entertain a motion.
Let's entertain a motion.
Mayor, I move to approve the modification to the conditional use permit for commercial properties at Biltmore, located at 700 Biltmore Avenue, subject to the site plan and elevations and conditions outlined in the technical review committee report, because the proposal meets the 7 conditional use permit standards as demonstrated by the applicant.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, thank you. We're hurrying through our agenda because this next item is what we really wanted to get to.
One other thing, the clerk reminded me, when we have a conditional use permit, there'll be findings of fact and conclusions of law that will appear on the consent agenda in 2 weeks for final approval.
Our next item, item E, is a public hearing to consider an amendment to section 7-2-5, 7-8-1D, and 7-13-3C of the Code of Ordinances to create a new land use that permits feline adoption together with retail sales known as Cat Cafe within the Central Business District, Vidilla Satvika. Did I do it right? Seriously, that's so picky.
Pretty close. Members of council, members of the public, my name is Vidilla Satvika, Planning and Urban Design. This is a consideration of a wording amendment to the Unified Development Ordinance to create a new land use that permits feline adoption together with retail sales to be defined as Cat Cafe within the Central Business District. The applicant is Brother Wolf Animal Rescue, a not-for-profit organization whose mission is to provide the resources and life-saving programs to build a no-kill community. Brother Wolf wants to create a cat cafe in downtown Asheville, which is a new model of mixing animal adoption with the experience of a cafe. The cat cafe model originated in Taiwan in 1998 and has since spread to North America with the opening of a cat cafe in Montreal in 2014. A number of additional cat cafes have opened throughout the U.S. and Canada with the twist of partnering with local animal shelters to showcase adoptable cats looking for new homes. in order to meet health standards, cat cafes are typically required to separate areas that house cats from food and beverages. Background: currently, the UDO precludes animal uses in the Central Business District. The only two uses in the various zoning districts that relate to live animals are kennels and veterinary clinics. The cat cafe can fit within the kennel use, but because kennels permit dogs, a potential nuisance for residents and businesses, staff believes permitting kennels within the CBD is not appropriate. The cat cafe would not meet veterinary clinic definition because it would only serve orphan cats that are in need of adoption, not providing medical services to any owned cat of the public, although medical services would be provided as needed to the cats in the adoption center. Staff proposes to create a new use that would only be permitted in the Central Business District that would be specific to housing orphan cats until they are adopted. The proposed new definition is as follows. Cat cafe means any premises used to house or contain homeless, orphaned, or unwanted cats, and that is owned, operated, or maintained by an organization that is licensed by the state as an animal shelter and devoted to the welfare, protection, and humane treatment of the animals for the purpose of adoption, and which incorporates retail sales to support the interaction of patrons with cats, such as a cafe, bookshop, or other permitted use. The proposed wording amendment would add cat cafe as a low impact land use under the office business classification in the land use impact table of section 717.3c. This table defines the intensity of land uses that govern compliance with development standards and nonconforming uses. The proposed wording amendment complies with the comprehensive plan's economic development goals and strategies by ensuring that city regulations are regularly reviewed and modified to meet the various changes of the local economic development situation. The proposed wording amendment also complies with the City Council's strategic plan by promoting innovative forms of development. Staff recommends approval of this wording amendment because the proposed change to the UDO is determined to be consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans, and is reasonable in that it will add to the city's dynamic and diverse culture and economy by contributing to the eclectic mix of creative, innovative businesses and the employment opportunities they provide. This concludes my report. I'll be free to take any questions.
So we wanted to show our new planning director how we do business in Asheville, so we're starting with a cat cafe on your first day. I don't have any questions. Do any of you have any questions before we open the public hearing? Okay, we're going to open the public hearing on the cat cafe. Okay. I thought for sure someone would have something. All right.
As a longtime cat owner or companion, and considering the number of dog bakeries in town, I think this is long overdue, actually. Yeah. So I'll make a motion.
All right.
I move to approve the proposed amendment to Section 725, Definitions 781D, Table of Permitted Uses, and Section 717.3C, Land Use Impact Table, to create a new low-impact land use that permits feline adoption together with retail sales to be defined as cat cafe within the Central Business District, and find this amendment is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans and is reasonable and in the public interest because it will add to the city's dynamic and diverse culture and economy by contributing to the eclectic mix of creative, innovative businesses and the employment opportunities they provide, and will get more cats adopted.
Second. Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say meow.
Meow.
Aye.
Any opposed? You have to say woof if you're opposed. All right, good. I hope that counts. All right. Okay, our last item. Item F is a public hearing to consider conditional zoning of property located at 311 and 315 Old Hawk Creek Road from RS4 Residential Single Family Medium Density District to Institutional District Conditional Zoning for church renovation, parking area, added sidewalks, and construction of 10 student housing units with associated infrastructure, with conditions for reduced property line buffers for portions of the site. Vidila Sotvika.
Thank you again. Vidila Sotvika again. So this is an application requesting a conditional rezoning from residential single family medium density, RS4, to institutional district CZ, conditional zone, in accordance with section 778 of the UDO, to allow for renovations of an existing place of worship, the construction of 10 student housing units, and to allow co-working kitchen and office spaces for a charge located at the address 311-315 Old Hawk Creek Road. This is the exhibit map. We have Old Hawk Creek Road here to the north and Bethesda Road. The property is bisected by Bethesda Road. There's a small portion of the property here, but the main part, a little over 6 acres, is seen here. This large square is a cemetery. It's about a quarter of the property. Currently, there's the church building here and the parsonage here. The buildings would look the same after this project would move forward. This is one of the existing parking lots, and there's a small existing parking lot here. The site is surrounded by RS4 residential homes, except for right here south of the property. This is a school of about 400 K-12 students. The applicant is seeking to create a more flexible use of their property to be able to continue as a place of worship while accommodating other uses. The plan is to create a multi-use property that houses students and seminarians year-round as part of a religious and educational community service curriculum. This is the color-coded site plan to help understand it a little bit. The striped pink lines are the cemetery, which would not be affected. This is the church, the parsonage. The proposed 10 small housing units are seen here on the southwest portion of the property. They are proposing new sidewalks. Buffer, and I'll talk about this in a minute. The plan for the curriculum is to create 10 tiny houses that would be built by students and the applicants. They would be about 500 square feet each, and they would hold up to 20 students, so about two, at a maximum about two each within each building. The sanctuary of the church would continue to be used as a place of worship for the four congregations that currently use the space. It would be renovated inside in order to be more flexible space so that it could accommodate community meetings and other events. The pews would be replaced with movable seating. Within that same structure, there is a fellowship hall. The fellowship hall will be remodeled and upgraded to include a co-working kitchen and makerspace, co-working office space, and a dining hall. These spaces would be available to the public for a charge, but there would be no retail sale of goods from the co-working spaces and no restaurant sales. There are also classrooms within that same structure as a sanctuary, and they will be used by students and instructors and may be available to the public for meeting spaces as part of the curriculum. The parsonage that's located away from the church here would continue to serve clergy and lay missionaries associated with the church as it has in the past. The project meets or exceeds requirements for access, sidewalk, parking, and also meets requirements for street trees, parking lot landscaping, street buffer, and building impact landscaping. The proposal does not meet the requirement for the property line buffer because here along the cemetery, in order to include a buffer, it would interfere with more than 75 graves. So the applicant is requesting a waiver of the property line buffer as a condition modifying the development standards along the cemetery, which we believe is appropriate in order to not impact those 75 graves. This proposal was approved with conditions by the Technical Review Committee on April 20th, 2015, and requires review by City Council and final TRC prior to final approval. The Planning and Zoning Commission recommended approving the proposal with a 3-2 vote. Two commissioners were concerned about the tiny homes. In addition to the required reviews, the applicant held two community outreach meetings and presented the project proposal to the Hawk Creek Homeowners Association. Two letters of support and one against the project have been received from the public as of the writing of the report. The proposal seeks a conditional zoning change from residential single family medium density RS4 district to institutional district conditional zone. The primary proposed use of the property will continue to function as a place of worship, as it has for many years. The zoning change to institutional CZ will allow student housing and the co-working spaces to be permitted uses on the site. The project would include commercial uses that would be subordinate and complementary to the primary use of the site as a place of worship while serving neighborhood residents. Appropriately scaled commercial activity within residential districts helps neighborhoods to be more walkable and bicycle friendly by offering relevant goods and services close by. For this reason, there exist various city goals that promote the development of mixed-use corridors and mixed-use development where appropriate. And the comprehensive plan states that appropriately scaled non-residential uses that serve residents of neighborhoods should be permitted in appropriate locations. For these reasons, staff believes the proposal is compatible with the site and the surrounding neighborhood and is consistent with broader city goals pertaining to the adaptive reuse of property. In regard to the density and maybe questions about the proposed density, under the current RS4 zoning, if the owner so chose, it would be permissible to subdivide the lot and build approximately four homes within the same 60,000 square foot area south of the church parsonage that is currently not built upon. So in comparison to what is permissible by right, 10 small cottages when combined will total less than half of what is permissible by right. The proposal complies with policies adopted by the city in several ways. As stated in the comprehensive plan, reusing older buildings is the most sustainable form of construction and helps to preserve and protect neighborhood vitality. And the plan states that appropriately scaled non-residential uses should be allowed in appropriate locations. The proposal is also aligned with the City Council's strategic plan by using the site to create an eastern hub for the applicant, thereby contributing to a sustainable financial future for Asheville by promoting an environment where citizens and businesses want to live, work, and invest. In addition, the project will enhance the quality of life for neighborhood residents by adding sidewalks that improve safety and provide more pedestrian connectivity. That's the blue line here. That's a new sidewalk along the entire property and bisecting the property here to allow students from the school to have their parents pick them up in this parking lot, which it would be allowed. Staff recommends approval of this proposed conditional rezoning with the landscape modifications for the property line buffer as described above. This concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to take any questions.
Questions?
Maybe for the developer.
Well, do we have the developer who's going to speak?
Madam Mayor, City Council members, my name is Larry Duggins. I am a pastor in the United Methodist Church and the leader of the Missional Wisdom Foundation, who is working in cooperation with Bethesda United Methodist Church, the Blue Ridge District of the United Methodist Church, and the Western North Carolina Annual Conference of the United Methodist Church to develop this project. We are looking to modify this existing church building to allow the formations of new types of Christian community. We are continuing worship in this facility by each of four congregations that are currently worshiping in this space, but we're making changes to the physical space to allow community formation in the way that people form community today. We find that people form community around their workplaces. And so that's the motivation behind the creation of the co-working spaces within the facility. We're talking about 800 square feet of co-working space for up to 20 people to share internet, office machines, and community with each other. We are also talking about the fact that people form community around food. So we would like to create a shared-use commercial kitchen in the space, modifying the kitchen that already exists within the space. Our idea is to bring people who create home-based products into compliance with law and into community with one another by providing them with shared-use space within their neighborhood to be able to do food preparation. Up to 4 workers would be allowed in the kitchen space at any one time. So we're not talking about a giant thing like they do up at AB Tech. Rather, we're talking about something that is sized for this community. We find that people form community around their children's schools. And so we're working to create a new relationship with Hall Creek Elementary, which is adjacent to this particular property. We've added already new signage to our parking spaces, inviting people to park in our parking lot to be able to walk across to pick up their children at school in an attempt to help to alleviate the traffic problem that exists at the entryway to Hall Creek Elementary. We're going a further step to create a sidewalk with gardens that goes from the parking lot to the elementary school to make it easier for children to be able to walk to these parking areas and to see growing food while they're doing that. We have already added a playground and picnic tables to that space to make it a family-friendly place to pick up their children. Finally, we're working with school administration to make sure that we are making all of our space available to the elementary school for both needs that they have and for desires that they have. The school's Spanish club has decided to come and meet in our space after school, and our space acts as a safe haven in case of emergency for the elementary school students. Finally, we are finding that people form community around shared recreational activities and around community activities. And so we're looking to modify the space so that it can be used more broadly for the community and for recreational activities. We're taking all of the pews out of the main sanctuary so that that space can be used not only for worship, but also for community meetings in the area. We believe that it will be the largest single space available in the Hall Creek neighborhood. Second, we have worked with a quilting group that exists within the church to develop them a new space to do their quilting work in the basement of the parsonage. We've about tripled the space available to them and added high-quality LED lighting to that space to make it possible for that type of community activity around quilting and sewing to grow in that neighborhood. We've brought in an Alcoholics Anonymous group who needed a place to meet and who is now meeting in our space. Finally, we have are in the process of adding out a little bit of space to be able to do woodworking in the garage space of the parsonage facility. The Mission of Wisdom Foundation is really does 2 different things. We do this kind of experimentation to be able to create new kinds of community, and then we teach people about that, and that's the second major portion of this redevelopment. We currently have plans to teach high school, college, and seminary students, as well as adults in clergy and adults in lay leadership, about this new kind of missional education, missional church, through immersion classes and retreats at the space. The Missional Wisdom Foundation includes, as a leader, Dr. Elaine Heath, who is the professor of evangelism at SMU Perkins School of Theology, and several of us hold advanced degrees in ministry and will be primarily responsible for the teaching that takes place on the site. We do want to add student housing in the form of 10 tiny houses on the site. We specifically want to use tiny houses to be able to achieve specific educational goals around that. First, we want our students to experience community living in a monastic, austere kind of environment in which we can teach the theology of sufficiency, how much is enough for an individual. Second, we want to expose our students to that particular kind of housing because we believe as a group that it has great potential for potential use as affordable housing in some areas, as housing for the homeless in some areas, simply an idea that people should become familiar with. We make very clear that on our site, the only use for those tiny houses is student housing. We're not doing affordable housing. We're not doing housing for the homeless in this location. As Vidilla mentioned, we have had four community meetings, two after we sent out direct mail invitations to over 2,400 households in the Haw Creek area. It's our estimate that we've met with over 350 people in these meetings, an informal meeting that we held in May, and in the Haw Creek Community Association meeting. We've also made an effort after our initial zoning review to speak with every neighbor that we have who had a concern and to reach out to people who expressed concerns during the zoning process. During these discussions, we had some misinformation come up that happens in this kind of thing in a neighborhood. But we also had some very legitimate issues come up that I want to be sure that we're clear about. First, this is not a retail space. We're not having retail sales from this location other than those kind of sales that churches typically have, bake sales, rummage sales, things like that. Second, this is not a restaurant space. We will not have food service to people for sale in this facility. Third, this is not a manufacturing facility. We're not manufacturing for sale tiny houses or anything else. This is, our building of tiny houses is an educational process for our students. Finally, this is not a business, it's a ministry. This does not have a profit motive. We are charging people, and in fact, we're in the process of working through to see whether we can legally make it simply a requested donation of people to be able to support the ongoing operation of this ministry and the other ministries of the foundation. There is no profit motive. There is no individual or corporation who receives profit from this venture. We've received a number of letters of support, which we provided to the council members individually, including support from Deborah Williams of Beverly Hanks Real Estate and of Brian Good, who's been associated with Asheville Green Opportunities and who is a kitchen entrepreneur who helped us design the kitchen space. In conclusion, this is a reaction to the fact that people used to form community around church activities, and they just don't do that anymore. Now they form community around work, around food, around their children's schools, and around recreational activities that they share with one another. This project is nothing more or nothing less and an attempt to repurpose the church building to match the way that people form community today, and to be doing that in a way that enhances the community and that provides healthy life to the neighborhood in Haw Creek. I'd like to note the support and participation of Chris Pelley in this process. Chris, we really do appreciate your help and advice. And then I'd also like to acknowledge and note Alan Glines and Vidila Sitvika as having been extremely important in this process for us. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, you had a question, though. Did it get answered?
Answered.
It got answered. Okay. So now I'll open the public hearing on this item. If there's anyone wishing to speak on this item, please come forward.
Mayor and Council, hi. My name's Lee Avishai. I live on Willowbrook Road, which is the next road down the road. My neighborhood was built developed in the 50s, early 60s. Most of my neighbors are quite elderly, and it's a beautiful neighborhood. And this is something that I'm concerned about because I think it sounds lovely, but I think it sets a very dangerous precedent in that there are a lot of churches in our neighborhood. In fact, there are one on each side, and they're all having problems. I mean, it's just a national trend that people are aging, and less people are coming to church, and a lot of churches are having difficulties because of that. And I'm just wondering, what's the next step? If this gets approved, when the Gospel Chapel finally succumbs to its aging population, will we build a trailer park there? I mean, as soon as this becomes, it's a very residential neighborhood. I don't know if you know it, but there's Tunnel Road, which is, of course, is very commercial. New Hawk Creek, which has a little commercial area, tiny. And now we're moving up the hill to Old Hawk Creek, and I just see it's like a quality of life that I think all of our neighbors have enjoyed for many years is really getting encroached on, and it's going to change the neighborhood. And I think as soon as you have a precedent where you have a commercial kitchen, and I did have a question whether there were going to be any food trucks involved in that, but if you have a commercial kitchen, then the next, I mean, it's just a matter of years until the Gospel Chapel goes under, and then what's going to happen on that property? And I just really feel it's unfair and inconsiderate of the people whose livelihood, I mean, our savings are tied up in our houses there, and that's what we expect to live on in our retirement, and I just feel like this is just gratuitous. I think it's unnecessary, and it sets a precedent that we're all going to suffer for in my neighborhood. I mean, I think if you would all ask yourselves the question is, would you want this on your block? And just be honest about the answer, because I think it's a lovely idea, but I don't think it's appropriate to my residential area, which we love, and it's, sorry.
Is there anyone else here wishing to speak on this item?
Mayor Mannheimer, Vice Mayor Mark Hunt, and members of council, I'm Barbara Melton. This time I'm not speaking from the coalition, I'm speaking from the board member of the Hawk Creek Community Association. As a board member, and I'm a lifelong resident of Hawk Creek, I've been associated, my family's been associated with Bethesda for over 100 years. I go to St. John's Episcopal right out the road. And we've had wonderful relationships with Bethesda. However, at the meetings that were held with the Community Association, we heard conflicting statements as to how the parsonage would be used, what size the tiny homes were. They started out at 250, then they, at the next PNZ meeting, they went to 350 or 400, now they're up to 500. We also questioned as to why they required a conditional zoning. The two meetings that were held with the Community Association were well attended. There was not one person there that spoke in favor of it. The last meeting we had to close it down because it just almost got out of hand. There was so much against it. I strongly advise you that at the Planning and Zoning Commission, it didn't make it into the minutes because I have a copy of them, but the two commissioners who voted against it because they said those homes would not be a sustainable development, and they could not vote on it for that reason. It was a 3-2 vote. There is room for them to add a dorm or whatever they need for their students in the back of the church, an attachment to the building. We ask at the Planning and Zoning and Building exactly what the community do with the tiny homes when these folks move out. They tell us we could tear them down or the taxpayers could tear them down. I didn't think that was a real good answer. I've been around a long time. I still don't think that's a good answer. I would ask council to consider the neighborhood. We have worked out our questions we had with the food and the office space with them. As long as they're not doing retail, we can live with that. And we understand they're trying to save their church. I don't blame them. I'd do the same thing if it was mine. But with these 10 tiny homes, this is not sustainable, and it's not something we need. Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak? Bill, just please state your name.
Madam Mayor, my name is Joe Bly, members of council. I'm at 5 Richard Street in Kenilworth. I own the house that's right there with my son. He's in residence at 49 Trinity Chapel Road. So he's a neighbor, you might say, of this project and of the congregation of Bethesda Methodist Church. I spoke at the first city of the Planning and Zoning Commission. I had not realized what was going on, but at that time, there's another neighbor nobody's speaking of here, and that's the school children of Hawk Creek School. They don't look contiguous on this margin. As a matter of fact, this does not look to me, and what you guys see is the lay of the land. There are deep woods between the church and this trailer park. And when I call them trailers, the Citizen Times article, all of them had wheels on them. The petitioners were going to build one on wheels so people could see them without having to go down and through the woods. Now, this deep, dark woods, I'd say it's got a family of bears living in it. These children, or whoever these novitiates or seminarians are called, they're going to take meals at the church and take their lessons. They're going to be walking near the schoolyard full of children. And so they're going to be transient, too. They're only going to live here one semester. This is a really bad idea, not just for the three families. I realize we don't have any power. However, there's a big difference between us and the petitioners. They don't live on the site. My son and Willa Gibbs and her neighbor up here, they live on the site. And they don't pay taxes. My son paid $1,274 last year in taxes on his house. His upper bedroom window is going to be in a level with the bedroom windows of these two-story 10 by 20 buildings. 200 square feet below, 200 square feet above. I assume it's two bedrooms and a bathroom. I hope it's a bathroom. And I understand they're going to take their meals at the church. This is a really bad idea to have these people in the middle. They're going to be in the middle of the woods. And for a real estate person to say that this trailer park doesn't depreciate my son's property is ludicrous. I mean, and these transients, the residents, are only going to be there 16 weeks. They're not going to be responsible to the community, and they're going to be in association with a schoolyard full of school children, which I think is a terrible idea. It's not going to be visible from the church. It's not going to be visible from the school. And the reason the Hawk Creek community is not too worried about it, my late wife and I carried a petition around to have Hawk Creek Road paved from Miller's store to Sonley Estate. So I'm a Hawk Creek person. I helped put the happy in Happy Valley, Hawk Creek. My reward is a 10-trailer trailer park in the backyard of my son. It is only feet to the
Thank you.
My son's back bedroom. I will say in closing that nobody has explained to us yet, and the widow Gibbs, and I'm not speaking her behalf here today. She called me, though. She could. Nobody's saying what, and I will say the councilman was there and saw the yellow ribbons on the trees. Are they going to cut down some of the trees in that buffer or not? Second of all, Madam Mayor, I would close by saying, let them build the trailer park in their backyard, not mine. They've got a big backyard behind the church. Why don't they put these 20 seminarians in their own backyard, not mine?
Thank you. Is there anyone else here wishing to speak on this item?
Good evening. My name is Margaret Burnett King. I live at 767 New Hawk Creek Road. And I'm a member of Bethesda United Methodist Church. I've been a member of this church for 65 years. My paternal grandparents were there since the 1920s. My maternal grandparents were there from the 1950s. My grandparents are buried in that cemetery. My dad attended that church from birth, 1921 to 2013, along with my mother, when she and my dad got married in 1947 until she passed away in 2004. My husband joined this church from Emma in 1973 when he and I got married. We are both very active in this church. As you can see, my roots are in this church. It's always been a community center for the Hall Creek community. Back in the beginning, when they drove the buggies and the horses to church, the people walked to church. That's the way they got to church. We didn't have cars. We didn't have roads. We didn't have to worry about that kind of stuff, they say. But the church was also a school. It was once the first school for Hall Creek. And there's a plaque in the cemetery there at Hall Creek that shows where the first school stood. We know that people come from out of the boundaries to go to church, but everybody's losing members. Every church is losing members. Just like Barbara said, that's what's happening. We knew we needed to come up with a new and innovative way to keep the name of Bethesda from being called at conference on the last day of conference as one of the churches to close in the conference. So I contacted our district superintendent, Reverend Dr. John Boggs, and I grabbed him by the arm one day and I said, we got to do something. We can't close the doors of this church because I'm going to go out of here laying on the floor, screaming like a baby, holding onto that carpet because we're not shutting these doors. That's been my place forever, since I was a child. So we came up with a plan and we talked to all the members of the church. We prayed about it. And it's kind of hard to accept some of the things that they had going, but I learned that there's things that need to be done to keep this church going and keep it an active place in Hall Creek community. It is a place of worship, and it's also a community center. The members of Missional Wisdom Foundation have given us all kinds of wonderful ideas. It's exciting things that are happening in our church, but we are, in foremost, a church, a place of worship. And we are a thriving church, and we hope that you will approve this ordinance today. Thank you.
Hello. Hi, I'm Karen Doucette. I'm the pastor at Bethesda United Methodist Church. I've been there about 9-10 weeks, not very long. But I can say that I grew up there. And I grew up there as a child on Trinity Chapel. I played in those woods. I swung from those trees. There was a goat right near there. I saw the Hall Creek Elementary be built. I learned how to play tennis on the back of it. I've run through the whole community all through my life. And now it's changing, and times have changed. And to be able to be a part of a way to give back to the community that I think would be life-giving and wonderful is to be a part of the project Hall Creek Commons. It is a wonderful opportunity to get connection with each other again in the community through vital ways of being able to come together and work, need to come together as families. I don't know, show a movie sometime outside up on that beautiful paved area right there. Right now, the playground is in place, and I'm hearing the bell ring where the kids are climbing up and just having a great time right there on the playground. I'm able to see now more people walking back and forth and curious about what's going on and asking questions and seeing that there's a lot of life going on, and this is what's happened the 10 weeks while I've been there. It's been vital to see the ways in which people want to connect. They want to find a place to belong, and this is a beautiful space that can be a connecting point for people. And in that way, I would really like to promote and say this is a great, valuable way for the 20, 30-something age group to come and be a part of the community and find a place to belong. Now, as far as the seminary students, the other day I was just trying to pick out which pen I wanted to use. You know, I have probably several at my house. And I was thinking of this in relationships to the small homes or the cottages they'll be living in. And I was thinking they're going to have to make a choice of what goes in there. And being able to learn how to decide between what your wants are and what your needs are is a great teaching experiment when we're
when we're young in age or in seminary. I think that's another vital way that this is a teaching component. In all that I've seen so far from the Missional Wisdom Foundation, they have said everything they've meant, and they have followed through with everything that they have done, and they have been completely generous in this effort, because more than anything, it's about loving others. And this is something that has been important, and it is important for all of us to see and witness and be a part of. So I'm looking forward to this opportunity of serving and seeing the different ways in which seminary students and those college students can take part in the community and be an asset to the community. Thank you for your time.
All right, anyone else?
Good evening, Mayor, council members. My name is Luke Lingle. I am a resident of West Asheville, not East Asheville, but I am also, I work for the Western North Carolina Conference of the United Methodist Church and have been a part of this project, both as a local member of our town and also as a part of the church. And I cannot tell you how excited we as the United Methodist Church are about this project, the positive impact that it can have on the Hall Creek community and the church and the people that live there. And one thing that I want to highlight is the nature of Hall Creek Elementary School and Bethesda United Methodist Church. In 1844, Bethesda UMC was founded, and it was founded as both a school building and a church. And in the corner of the cemetery, you can see the placard. And one of the things that I'm very excited about with this project is, come full circle, we're now going to be training seminarians and college students and also partnering with the school next door in order to be a place where students can play on the playground or walk to their car safely with their parents, but also know that their community is vibrant and will be vibrant for years to come. We are, as the United Methodist Church, very excited. I bring greetings from Bishop Larry Goodpastor, the resident bishop. He is flying back in from Cambodia today and could not be here, or otherwise he would have been, and must say that we are very excited at our conference about this project, and thank you for your consideration. Thank you so much.
Good evening, Mayor, council members. My name is Sean Rice. I'm the director of RFD Constructs. We have been part of the team working on this development and will provide the general contracting services for its construction when approved. I wanted to respond to a couple of the questions I heard, if that's okay. One of which were the trees, and that the trees are marked with yellow ribbons. Mr. Bly and I, along with Dr. Duggins, have walked in those woods together. And those yellow ribbons are from a tree survey, and they mark the trees that will remain. They just needed to be counted for the process. But we did that together, and that was really communicated. The other question I heard is what will happen if this is set as a precedent for churches? And I think it needs to be pointed out that this is conditional reuse, and that all those churches would have to go through the same process, and you would have to approve of those individually. This is not setting a standard that they could all automatically have this kind of project. Those are the only two questions I heard, but if there are any others, I'd be glad to respond to them.
Mayor, I heard one other statement. Were the trailers on wheels?
The 10 houses are simply that, they're houses and they're small. They're not on wheels, they are not trailers. They are not going to be constructed in any manner similar to that. They will be built in an energy-efficient way using as many local resources as we can. They will be built to last for hundreds of years.
They'll be on a slab then?
Some will be on a slab. Some others may be on a crawl space, and that will just be because of the land and to be able to teach a couple of different things, different techniques. We will construct a tiny home on a trailer. It will not... Those will not remain on site. They're just going to be built as a teaching element to part of the seminary students. So those will be on wheels, but not the ones they're living in, not the ones that will remain permanently on site. Sir.
Yeah, I have a question. With a long history in the building trades, it's really apparent to me that the big problem with tiny homes is that there's a very high material use per square foot, and they're much less energy efficient than if you put 10 500 square foot apartments in a block together. You gain all the advantages of HVAC and piping, and the size of the footprint on the land is smaller, actually. Well, it disturbs less land. So that's the, other than that, this project seems terrific to me, but I don't see the energy efficiency piece at all. I don't get it.
Okay. Well, I would respond to that. I understand what you're saying, and that when you combine units, there is some savings there in your thermal mass and your HVAC. But to have those as individual units, even if it was a dorm set up, each one would have its own HVAC system. So I see that you're gaining some insulation from the units around it insulating each other. All of these are going to have many split systems. You know, we're looking at 21 SEER. I mean, just highly efficient systems. The square footage, I see that some of the square footage might be reduced if it was a dorm style, but at 500 to 600 square feet, or 250 to 300 square foot per person, I don't feel like that's a large footprint per person. I mean, far smaller than any residential home if you look at a family of four. And then when you also have those units, a lot of times you have corridors and common space, and these aren't going to have that extra area that might come with combining into a dorm style. I actually think that we would end up with a little bit less square footage. But that
okay, is my thanks.
And I'm not sure you're the person to answer all
this. If I'm not, I will step okay. away and we'll get the right person.
Okay, great. One of the concerns that we heard was there was going to be construction of tiny houses on the property. And you just said that you thought the seminarians would actually work on building tiny houses for demonstration purposes off the property. Mm-hmm. Do you have a sense of how much construction is going to be on site?
Absolutely. And I'm sorry, was that the end of your question?
And this may be for city staff, but the question I've got is, they talked about the fact that retail sales wouldn't be on the property. But is that part of the conditions?
It is.
It is. Okay, so that's all spelled
it's
out.
It's all a part of Exhibit B, and one of those is that the construction can only happen in one area. It's right here. It's between two retaining walls behind the house. So it's shielded from view from the road. It will help shield from the sound because there's a retaining wall that goes up to 8 feet on either side, and it's limited to four of those per year that can be constructed. And I doubt that we'll get to four a year. It'll probably be more like two a year. But all those are in Exhibit B.
Yeah, just to put up the
time of day. The construction will be restricted working hours. I believe it's, does it say 8 to 5 or 9 to 5? I think it says 9 to 5. Sorry, I didn't have it in front of me.
Yeah, just to reiterate, the B1 conditions list that go along with this rezoning state that the teaching curriculum would be allowed to construct up to four tiny homes per year, but not for commercial sales. And construction would occur between the hours of 9 to 5.
Okay.
There's a couple more on the other side of this, but I'll just leave this one up.
Okay.
Any more questions for me or other folks on our team?
Good.
Thank you.
All right, anyone else wishing to speak on this item? We're still in the middle of the public hearing.
Hello, Mayor and City Council. My name is Lisa Gibbs, and I live close to the woods where this is going to happen. And I just have a question. If the tiny houses are going to be built year after year, what for? Can somebody?
Maybe somebody can come up. Is that it? Is that all you have? This is your opportunity to comment. Is there any other thing, anything else you'd like to say?
I know if they're going to build them, you know, for a year, what's going to happen to those?
Okay, thank you.
I think we need to make a distinction for you and for the community about the tiny homes that are permanently located on the property and tiny homes that are built for educational purposes. We intend to build up to 10 tiny homes, as shown on the map that we've been looking at, that are on permanent foundations built to residential housing codes, and that are there as part of our teaching infrastructure on this site. We're also planning to build up to 4 of these tiny houses on trailers, so that after our infrastructure is built and we have another round of students come in, we can have them have the experience of building one of these houses, because quite frankly, one of the things that we believe is that in some places, these are wonderful alternatives to other kinds of residential living. We want to, as part of our organization's focus on theological education and on the focus on the theology of adequacy, sufficiency, that our students themselves have the chance to actually do this. Now, we heard the comments back from the immediate neighbors and from the neighborhood that we needed to be careful about noise. And so that's why we agreed to limit to daylight hours. That's why we agreed to limit to only 4. And that's why we agreed to limit to not sell the things. These are going to be for teaching tools. It's part of educating people to be pastors and religious leaders in the 21st century.
Question there.
Yes, sir.
So building a tiny home as a teaching tool, the learning happens while it's being built. Then what happens to the structure? I think I heard you say it's not going to be sold.
It will not be sold. We will give them away. We'll send them off with people who have a use for them in their area. We'll find a use for them. The one that we are building now, I mean, we have one that is on a trailer that we're building on site that showed y'all. We're going to use as a teaching tool to take to local United Methodist congregations to roll it in their parking lot. People walk into them and get a feeling for what tiny houses really represent.
Okay, any other questions? While we're kind of doing this back and forth.
That was it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, anybody else wishing to comment on this item? You get one bite at the apple. Is there anyone else wishing to comment on this item? Okay. I'm going to close the public hearing. And are there questions, comments, or a motion?
Mayor, I move to approve the conditional zoning request for Hawk Creek Commons at 311 and 315 Old Hawk Creek Road from RS4 residential single family medium density to institutional CZ institutional conditional zone, with the conditions for the property line buffer waiver along the cemetery based on the master plan, and find that the request is reasonable, is in the public interest, and is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans in the following way. 1, the project proposes the reuse of an existing building, the most sustainable form of development. 2, the project will provide neighborhood scale co-working spaces that will serve residents of Hawk Creek. And 3, the project improves access and safety for users of the site as well as for neighbors by adding sidewalks along the streets and through the property itself.
Second.
Okay, I have a second. Motion and a second. Any other?
I have a question for Vadilla.
He's right there.
Well, there you are. In regard to expression of neighborhood concerns, you know, we've had a couple of people express concerns about this tonight. Could you review for us the input staff has gotten, the amount of input from opponents to this that materialized at the Planning and Zoning Commission? Just review the history of
sure.
position of this.
Sure. To date, I have 2 letters of support and 1 against. This project went to the Planning and Zoning Commission twice. At the first Planning and Zoning Commission hearing, it was clear that there were unanswered questions and the applicant preferred to not have a decision from the Planning and Zoning Commission, and so we tabled and came back to the Planning and Zoning Commission. Don't have the date here somewhere. But then through that process at the second Planning and Zoning Commission, we worked through a lot more of the questions. Mostly they had to do with tiny houses as a concept versus dorms, just like it came up a little bit today, sort of the theory of what type of housing should be built, and the question of commercial activity. One thing that wasn't included in my report here, just to reiterate to the public and to you, is that less than 10% of this proposal would include a commercial component. And in comparison, we allow, with our home occupation rules, any home in the city can have up to 25% of their home as their home occupation. So just to reiterate that commercial activity is not precluded from residential areas, but we definitely think it should be subordinate, and we believe it is subordinate here. So that covers a little bit of your question. Is that?
That's good. Thank you. Mayor, I'm sorry.
You had a follow-up question?
It's different.
Okay, good.
Well, I'm going to express a little bit of concern about the...
Is this a question?
No, this is would be for the developer, actually.
Okay.
I confess to not having focused until just now on the notion of producing 4 tiny homes per year, that this would be a production facility for tiny homes that would be taken away from the property. And the reason I'm concerned is that we're still talking about primarily a residential neighborhood. And I think that neighbors expect that when there's the noise of construction, it's going to be very temporary and it's going to go away. So I might remodel a house or put an addition on whatever, and then it doesn't happen. But here we're talking about a cyclical sort of thing. And I've got concerns. The question for the developer is, how critical is being able to produce 4 tiny homes per year on this property to the enterprise? And, pastor of the church, anyone else that wants to speak to that, I think it's a key concern of mine at least.
I understand. We have acted to do the very best that we can do to mitigate the noise associated with that by agreeing to only do the construction in the area that you saw the existing trailer in. And so there are high walls on either side that reduce noise there. Second, we agreed to put a limitation of 4 based on the community feedback that we were getting during the actual hearing in the Planning and Zoning Commission. That is a requirement that we agreed to on the fly in that meeting. We feel like, given the throughput of our program, that will be sufficient to be able to have the opportunities for people to work on these projects.
So what I've heard is that you would like for the seminarians to be able to have the experience of learning about construction, building tiny homes, is something they can take away, and that's the purpose of this. And
it is.
And if that goes away, if that condition is eliminated here, how does that affect the
program? If we're not allowed to create tiny homes on that site after the initial construction is done,
it
removes a teaching component that we are trying to incorporate into our curriculum. We find it very important to give people the actual experience of doing something rather than simply reading it or simply going and watching one be built. It's different to stand up there and hammer a nail into a stud than it is to read about having that happen. We believe, and again, it comes back to the fact that we believe that tiny homes are a viable alternative to address affordable housing issues and to address theology of sufficiency, both of which are very important for pastoral leaders. So that's why we think it's important.
I hear the benefit of that.
Yes.
I think I'd like to offer an amendment that I would support this with approval, except for the ability to produce 4 tiny homes per year. And I just offer that as an amendment.
Can you restate the motion? The amendment?
The amendment would be to approve the project as moved, with the exception of the one condition that allows for the production of 4 tiny homes per year for export from the site, for lack of a better term.
Okay, do I have a second on the motion to amend the motion?
Friendly amendment that you're asking for?
No, I don't know if it's friendly or not, but I'm concerned about the noise in the neighborhood.
I am too, and frankly, and I seconded the original motion, and I feel a bit, I won't say misled, but I just did not understand that this would be an ongoing production of tiny homes. I felt like that the 10 homes with the one transit or portable home, for lack of a better term, was what we were talking about. So this would be an ongoing, we're going to get to 10, and then we're going to continue to do those on wheels to take to other places. That's a commercial use I don't see in the neighborhood.
I wonder if it would be possible to enclose, and these are tiny houses, to build a structure that would deaden the sound, so they built them inside.
The way they do over at Wishbone.
Yeah.
There's part of it, of Exhibit B, is saying that we'll come back in 1 year to evaluate that at P&Z and see if this has really been a noise issue of concern or not. That's part of Exhibit B.
And just to speak to that, I've heard a lot of concerns about this proposal, but I haven't heard from neighbors that there's concerns about noise. We have to remember this is a 6-acre site adjoining a 20-acre elementary school site. And there are some residential nearby, but there's a lot of elbow room out there too. And the site where they're building them is down below grade. So again, I don't think that's the issue that my perceived
state. Well, with respect, for me, it's the uses that occur in residential districts. I mean, it's we would never approve a home occupation that involved, no matter how large the lot, that would involve building buildings and exporting them out of the backyard. So. I'll also offer that the production of the additional tiny homes doesn't necessarily have to happen on this site for the students to participate. There are sites elsewhere that are zoned, for instance, commercial or industrial or whatever, that where it could occur. That granted would be not as convenient as on the site. So,
So I really appreciate how innovative this project is that you're bringing to us, and the conceptualization of how to better bring communities together, I think, is very forward-looking and innovative in ways that there's something for every member of the community and every member of council to really appreciate about what you're doing. This path to the school and the partnership there, the playground, the picnic tables, the fact that you're having the quilters there, I think that's the sweetest thing I've ever heard. The DIY woodworking, the community space, the co-working, preserving the cemetery, the fact that there's 4 different congregations using this is something very poignant about that as well. I misunderstood until tonight's presentation about the construction ongoing year after year on the site. That wasn't something that I was aware of until the presentation tonight. And I would agree with Vice Mayor Hunt that I think that identifying an alternative site for swinging those hammers is something that is going to be able to better serve all of the other things that you're trying to do if that banging isn't happening. And I appreciate what you've done with the retaining walls, too. I think that's really going to help in the construction of the 10 that you have there. But I would really encourage an alternative site if we're going to be building houses in ongoing activity in a residential neighborhood.
So were you seconding the motion to amend the motion?
I will. I thought Jan did, but I'm.
Well, Jan seemed like he was.
I fell short of that.
You weren't sure. Okay.
Yeah, yes. Almost pulled the trigger, but you did. You just did it. So we have a motion and a second on the amendment to the motion. Are there any other further questions, comments before we vote?
Are we going to vote first on the amendment?
Yeah. So what we do is you're going to vote on the motion to amend the motion. And the motion to amend is to remove this provision that would allow for continuous construction.
So an aye vote is to remove the provision.
That's right. Are we clear? We're clear. Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Okay, so now we have the motion as amended to approve this item.
And I wanted to interject one other comment. For the people who are concerned about what's going to happen to these 10 tiny houses if the whole operation ends and moves on, it's good to know that a 500 square foot house is really easy to move. And if they're well constructed, they can be picked up and sold elsewhere or hauled elsewhere. So they aren't going to be a permanent blight on the neighborhood going forward, I don't think. I don't know why they would be. I've moved houses that size.
Mayor, I just wanted to clarify one thing before you go forward. This is a conditional rezoning, so the applicant has to consent to all conditions. And I think we just need to make clear what the amendment is as it relates to the condition and make sure that the applicant consents to that or even wants to move forward on that basis. Mm-hmm. Condition 2A refers to the teaching curriculum being allowed to construct up to 4 tiny houses. And Vidilla, you may be able to help with this. As I'm reading it, it is being construed at this time to have that use as being part of the teaching curriculum, and you're restricting how much they can do it. So I think that the condition now would be that you could not do that, not that you can only be limited to do it, that it actually would be a prohibited use. Is that Vidilla or Alan?
And the item before is the permission to build the tiny homes in the first place, it looks like.
The original tiny
homes. The original.
The 10.
What we're discussing is removing 2A as a permitted use.
Removing the ability to actually construct tiny houses on the property at all, I think, is what the motion is.
After
beyond
the initial 10, right? You can build the 10, but as a training mechanism. Well, they may use the first 10 as a training.
Right.
Mechanism.
Right. Okay. But beyond the first 10.
Exactly.
Okay. Yes, we would agree with that.
Okay. All right, ready?
Mayor, just a couple quick comments. I live out in Hawk Creek, as many of you know, and I'm a neighbor to people on all sides of this issue here. And just a couple quick thoughts before we vote on this. Hawk Creek is zoned nearly entirely residential. There's very little commercial component to it. There's a small section with 2 or 3 commercial buildings, other than once you get out to Tunnel Road. And having lived there over 20 years, one of the things I noticed is that there really is very limited number of places for the community to gather in a setting other than, you know, in a private home. So I'm really heartened by the opportunities that this proposal presents to the community here. I'm heartened to hear, and I sat in on a meeting with the elementary school administrators and the leaders of this project here, and there was almost an instant kind of connection on ways that they can help and support each other here, that we've already begun implementing that with the parking proposal. If you've ever driven there at 8:30 in the morning or 3 o'clock at children pickup time, there are long backup lines, and this is a real qualitative improvement by allowing parents to park there and walk over and pick up their kids. And for folks who have a hard time conceptualizing what this will look like in the future, I think the staff report that cites the Harvest House in Kenilworth is a very good example of a type of facility that is similar in many ways to what's being offered here. And I think Kenilworth residents will tell you it's only been a positive attribute to that community there. So I'm strongly supportive of this, and I thank you all for bringing it forward.
Okay, anyone else? All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
All right, thank you very much. That concludes our public hearings agenda. We have no unfinished business. And under new business, boards and commissions, I will hand it over to the Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Can we leave the room quietly, please? Quietly, please.
Vidilla, we asked them to go in the hall and.
Thank you, Mayor. Boards and Commissions Committee met this afternoon just before the City Council and considered a number of items. The first is appointments to the Hub Community Economic Development Alliance Board. There are three vacancies coming up. All three incumbents in those roles are eligible for reappointment. The committee recommends the reappointment of Julie Mayfield, Edward Hay, and Jerome Jones. So that would be a motion by the committee.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The next item is discussion of consideration of representatives from the Neighborhood Advisory Committee in SACE to the Multimodal Transportation Commission. The committee recommends that we extend this to a date indefinite. We feel like we need some more process. One of the nominees by one of the committees may be a little bit conflicted in that he's an employee of county government serving in a role that directly involves transportation. And so I offered to the committee to speak with the head of SACE and other people involved and see when we can bring this back, depending on finding additional nominees. So that would be the recommendation there. Is there any concern about that approach at all? Okay, we'll just move forward in that light. Recreation Board, there are four vacancies to fill. We actually have four applicants. The committee feels that we have four qualified applicants and recommends their appointment, and those are Dean Pistor, Helen Hyatt, Laura Carlson, and Pat Dennehy. So that's a motion to appoint those four members to the Recreation Board.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye for me too. I was a little slow. None opposed, I believe. Finally, Tourism Development Authority. Over the past few days, there's been a little sort of one-on-one discussion among some on council about this topic, and the Boards and Commissions Committee discussed it. And our committee mayor recommends that we transition with appointments to this board to a process similar to that we use with the Board of Education and the Planning and Zoning Commission. Those processes being ones that include essay questions that are submitted in advance and interviews in open public sessions in this room that are available by video and televised. So we'd like to transition over a little bit of time toward that sort of approach with our appointments to the TDA. In this case, because we do have an opening coming up and we're a little bit under the gun, we recommend that we extend the application period for 2 weeks. And in our first meeting in October, Maggie, help me if I'm getting this wrong. In our first meeting in October, we would interview however many applicants that we have in open session in this room. And that would be just prior to the council session on that date.
Without the questions.
But without the advance.
Just do an open format.
Open format interview. So that's our recommendation for the process this time around. We do have one applicant, as noted in the agenda, and there may be additional applicants over the next 2 weeks, but that's our recommendation for this process. Any comments or discussion on that? Everybody feel okay? Gwen, you look puzzled. I hope I haven't.
It looked like we had two applicants. But
yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. One of this position must be filled by a person involved with a lodging facility with 100 or more beds, and the second applicant is simply a standing applicant for future appointments, but doesn't qualify for this appointment. I'm sorry. Okay. Any other thoughts on that? Shall we move forward in that vein?
Yes, please.
Thank you.
Okay. So this is the public comment period, and the public comment format is that you can receive 3 minutes. If you would like to speak, just begin by stating your name and watch the lights on the podium. When it's green, you're good to go. Yellow means you're getting close, or orange, whatever color it is. You're getting close to the end, and then red and the buzzer means stop, and if you would be so kind as to stop at that point so we can let anyone else who would like to speak come forward. And we will have a closed session tonight, so we will finish with a motion to go into closed session. So I don't have anyone signed up to speak, so let's just go ahead and see who would like to speak. Yes.
Madam Mayor, council members, my name is Inge Durban. I have been a downtown resident since 2011, and in order to get a sense of who in the audience is here in support of the preservation of the Collierwood, or Collier Avenue Wood, I ask that you stand, so we get a sense of who's here. Thank you. Actually, I'm speaking for the group and would like to get a longer period, if that is possible. And I have prepared something in writing so I can be concise and to the point. Is that appropriate? Yeah.
Okay, if you'll show us who is yielding their time, then you can have up to 10 minutes. One, two, three. Okay, if you've yielded your time, that's it. You're not going to speak on this. Thank you. Go ahead, 10 minutes.
I ask city council members to help preserve the wood of 11 Collier Avenue. According to a tree evaluation report provided by a local certified arborist, who incidentally is a former city tree commission member, this property, and I quote, contains 23 mature, 80 to 100-year-old native oak trees, which makes this wood a singular occurrence in the hardscape of the city center area. The stand serves several ecosystem functions, such as cleaning air, sequestering carbon, moderating noise, mitigating heat island effect, and capturing stormwater runoff. As such, these trees serve the citizens of the immediate neighborhood and of the entire city, end of quote. Now I want to make a few comments in addition to citing the content of the tree report. First, I understand that City Council lets itself be guided by its plans and that the preservation of this wood was not part of any of the city's long-range plans. However, now that an opportunity exists in favor of the preservation of the wood by way of our groundwork, the chance to conserve this historically significant forest should be seized. The existence of the forest had gone unnoticed by many or all residents for a long time, but now that its significance has been uncovered, every effort must be made to preserve these trees. Second, not only has the property owner of the Collier Avenue Wood agreed with us on the worthiness of a preservation effort, he also has indicated his willingness to consider including affordable housing into his development on a different lot, should the city agree to a property exchange of some sort. This is something City Council often professes to be one of its most pressing priorities, and the development plans for the 11 Collier Avenue wooded area do not contain affordable housing. Third, I wish to liken the chance to preserve this precious forest to an unexpected archaeological find during an excavation for construction that must be preserved rather than ignored and destroyed to avoid extra costs. Fourth, there is no green space in all of the South Slope, certainly none within 2.5 minutes of walking distance from the next, something the city's Parks and Greenways plan states as one of its goals. This green space does not need to be created. It exists, begging for preservation. Fifth, comparisons between the St. Lawrence Basilica Green and the Collier Avenue Wood have been made. I do not see how the two initiatives are comparable, except that they are both grassroots efforts backed by a large and diverse group of citizens. In no other respect are the two efforts alike. The Collier Avenue Wood initiative is an effort to preserve and protect an existing, as it turns out, unique, undisturbed urban forest, whereas the Basilica Green effort is an attempt to create a green space where currently one is missing. Sixth, yes, we are committed to fundraising in amounts currently unknown. Certainly, I would like to suggest that we form a neighborhood group set up as a 501c3 nonprofit group. And as a nonprofit, we could then apply for grants to fund maintenance costs and cover additional costs. Donations and membership contributions could be collected for needed improvements, such as a trail with a bench or two. We are interested in conserving the forest as is, as a so-called passive park, with a little modification, with as little modification as possible, thus requiring little upkeep, as the past decade has demonstrated. Seventh, we have received letters of support from local organizations, first and foremost from the Preservation Society of Asheville and Buncombe County. In his letter, Jack Thompson, the Preservation Society's executive director, expressly discourages the city from removing the trees. We have also received a letter of support from the city's Tree Commission and the Sierra Club, both of which support the preservation of the trees. Park, Audubon Society, Karen Ramshaw of the Public Interest Project, Nancy Stairs of the North Carolina Forest Service, Mr. Nutter, and many others have indicated their support for preservation of this precious wood in writing or by their action. Eighth, in fact, in looking at historical photos and maps of the area dating back to 1910, 1912, and 1923, respectively, it is now clear that these trees stand on the former campus of the Ravenscroft School and are located next to an alley that used to be an extension of Ravenscroft Drive, whose lower end was later renamed Collier Avenue. In accordance with Mr. Nutter, I suggest that the wood be renamed Ravenscroft Wood, and that the name of the adjacent alley, that is the upper trunk of Collier Avenue, be renamed Ravenscroft Drive. Ninth, on last check, there were 1,061 signatures in support of the online petition. In closing, I urge you to rally behind this broad-based preservation initiative by agreeing to negotiations with a property owner in search of a way to make this an all-around win-win situation. Thank you. I have packages for each of you that I forgot to hand out before.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak? Yes. If you'll just state your name.
Madam Mayor and council members, my name is David Johnson. I'm a retired professor of planning and ecology at the University of Tennessee, but I have been a resident here for 15 years. I worked on saving trees around the world in my career in the Amazon and Brazil and in the northern areas of Kenya in the desert. It's appropriate for me to, and I'm pleased to be able to add my voice to the voices here asking that these trees be saved. I don't need to tell this council how important trees are. What would Asheville be without trees? This makes our city what it is. Why are these trees important? Because they are old trees. We've had them for a long time. We're saving and protecting our old buildings, but our old trees are also important. And these trees are in a very special place. They're in the center of the city. So we really ought to ask the question, do trees have rights? Do trees have standing, legal standing? And I think they do. And so anything that you folks can do to preserve the trees, these trees in our downtown, we'll all be grateful if you can do that. Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes.
Madam Mayor and members of City Council and members of the public, I'm Im Kadura. I'm a resident of the Sawyer Motor Building in the heart of the South Slope, near the Collier Avenue Wood that the previous two commenters have spoken about. I bought a condominium in that building in 2002. One of the attractive features of being in that building was that there is some nature nearby. Of course, at that time, there were many abandoned buildings also. Now we have a growing South Slope, a revitalized South Slope area, and many people want to build many things, other than breweries, on that site. However, I ask you to also think of the existing residents, of those who've been committed to living in downtown and who enjoy having trees around. And you may ask yourself, someone who doesn't see what do they care about a tree? Well, I can open my window, I can hear birds that I cannot hear near buildings. Some mornings in spring, you can hear a woodpecker, which doesn't usually happen when you just have a single tree somewhere. I could also smell the air and hear the wind in the trees. Clearly, it sounds and feels different from if there is another building right there. The mixture of trees and buildings in a city adds softness, especially for those of us who live right there, who want to maybe walk past some open space. But don't just listen to me, I'm not alone. I talked to neighbors when we first found out about the prospective building of an apartment building in the place of those trees, and they all felt the same way, as do the signers of our online petition. The people who have sat in this meeting for 2.5 hours and are still here, plus those who would have liked to come but couldn't. We have all the different organizations that have been listed that support the preservation of the trees. And even the developer would like to support it and seems to be very open to discussions regarding how to best swap properties or in a way that is a win-win situation for everybody and saves the trees. So it is really now up to the city to step up and go with the community who is ready to do things and help preserve these trees. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, in the back.
Good evening. My name is Andy Clark. I'm also a resident of the South Slope, where there is now a brewery on every corner. We wore green shirts here today, and that signifies a number of things. One, of course, is the environmental aspect, the aesthetic aspect. I'd also like to focus here on the economic aspect. We do have a lot of breweries in our neighborhood. They make great beer. They make great neighbors. We have busloads now of beer tourists that come in every evening, and that's a good thing, too. And they enjoy walking down the wooded lanes. Every great city in this country has trees that they revere, Central Park, Audubon Park,
Golden Gate, Shady Grove in Austin. For those of you who don't know the trees that we're talking about here, go to just about any place along Patton Avenue. Go to the top of Cox Avenue and look down. It is the patch of trees that you see, the patch of trees that you see downtown. That independent arborist report that you just got, he did a survey, did a GIS map. That represents 10% of all the trees downtown on this half-acre lot, on this 0.5-acre lot that they're talking about building an apartment building that'll house 50 people. I think if you look at the cost-benefit between the two, cities of this size all around the country, even half this size, spend millions of dollars a year of their budget to plant trees, to maintain trees. You know, yes, we're a beer city. We're proud of that. We're supposed to be a tree city, too. And if you look at the cost avoidance of not cutting these trees down, the cost it would cost the city to go around and plant saplings around and try and replace that 10%, I think the $200,000 or $300,000 that I think this developer would sell back or trade this land for some of equal value is immeasurable importance. Someone once said that societies, or in our case we can say a city, begins to become great when old men plant trees, realizing that they'll never live to share their shade. What can we say if men and women are going to cut down all these trees? What can we say about ourselves then? I'd like you to think about what it's going to cost us in many terms, including economic terms, if these trees are destroyed. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hello, Mayor and City Council. My name is Brendan Lafferty, and I've been a resident of Asheville for 16 years and am entirely proud of the city I live in. I absolutely love Asheville. And having sat for the time I've sat here from the beginning till now, I can look around and see your involved faces and how this community works. And I've never taken part in City Council before. I've never taken part to this level in the inner workings of Asheville. But I'm proud to be here today. And the reason I'm here is because I received an email. Let me back up. The reason I live in Asheville, I had never been here before I ever lived here. I was moved by what people told me when I met them during my hike on Appalachian Trail 99. Strange enough, my trail name was Tree. That's just ironic to this moment. But what it does is it makes me have an appreciation for Asheville and the greenery that it has. And that's one of the things 16 years ago when I moved here that caught me, and it still catches me today. I love to walk around town. I love to walk around West Asheville, the areas. And I just thoroughly love the city I live in. So I request that you give some heartfelt thought to saving this plot of trees. If we all remember as a kid when we drew pictures, we almost always put trees in them. They're an innate feeling in us to be a part of the landscape and the culture we live. Thank you for your time. I appreciate that.
Thank you. The mayor stepped away for just a minute, and so I'm taking over momentarily. Additional comments on this, please.
Good evening. My name is Lila Schwartz. I've had a business downtown at 60 Biltmore Avenue for 33 years. I have merged my business with a business at 120 Cox Avenue. It's called One Center Yoga. We back up to this plot of land where the trees are. What has not been mentioned, I want to, of course, ditto the value of trees in the city, their value for air quality, and all the aforementioned points. What people may not recognize is that these trees are on a very high piece of land. The retaining wall at the back of the parking lot of our building currently is about 11 foot. There's another 11 to 12 foot. It's a setback of about 5 feet and another 11 to 12 feet of embankment that these trees are holding in place. And I think that's worthy of mention. So it has a lot of different value, but it also has the value of containing the land that's there. And I hope you do consider, I know it's always about money, and I hope something can be worked out with the developer. It would be a shame to lose that aged forest and those beautiful trees. Thank you.
Jeez.
You got it upside down, Steve. There you go.
My name is Steve Rasmussen, and as some of you know, I became involved in work on the downtown master plan after Lady Passion and I discovered how difficult it was to save that iconic magnolia tree out in front of City Hall because of the city's previous lack of real planning towards that component of its triple bottom line goal, which is social, economic, and environmental sustainability. Anyway, this is, when I discovered the address of this property, of course I went to the main part of the downtown master plan that has to do with supporting that environmental leg, and that's the Parks and Greenways map. And lo and behold, smack in the middle of one of the main South Slope recommended park target areas in the downtown master plan is Levin Collier. The purpose of these areas is to carry out the 1920s Nolan plan of having a place where you can sit and refresh yourself under in greenery every at a walkable distances as people come or go from downtown, and to ensure that Asheville it can preserve its livability as we try to find more ways to wedge more people into our ever more popular downtown area. Not too long ago, we flew a flag out in front of the planning and I want to call it the Taj Garage, you know the place I mean, that proclaimed our status as a Tree City USA. And to many, many people, that's exactly what we are. We say that trees are very valuable to us. In practice, I don't see this being paid a lot of attention to lately. I think it's very important that the city make this a priority to show its commitment to this plan. So we're proving that this plan is not gathering dust on the shelves, as so many people warned us would happen to the downtown master plan. Find a way to make this park happen, because it's exactly where it's supposed to be, and you know, we need it. Thank you very much.
Okay, anyone else? No? Okay, that concludes the public comment period for the evening.
We also have an informal discussion sometimes, and I would like to comment on this, and that is that over the years that I've lived in Buncombe County, it's about 35 years now, and been a visitor at first to downtown and then moved into the city in 2002, I've watched the trees disappearing here. There was a beautiful old linden on Battery Park. It was all gnarly and probably not in real good shape, but that disappeared. Just lately, with the new hotel going up across from the Grove Arcade, the first thing they did was cut down all the pretty mature trees in the parking lot that were in their way. I noticed kind of with irony that across from the post office, the city redid the sidewalks and put in a whole line of new trees, and then the Buncombe County decided to build a parking garage and tore out all the trees and is messing up the sidewalk again. That seemed kind of, something should have been coordinated better there. But over and over again, we lose these trees. And as one commenter made note of, you can't replace old trees. That's just, there's no way to do it. And I would hope that we can find some way to facilitate this, whether it is a land swap, whether it is helping to facilitate raising private funds to purchase this. There are ways to go about this, and if the developers are willing to hold off and talk about this a little longer, I would think we can find some way to do it. The master plan was mentioned. One of the things in there is that we're supposed to, one of the goals is to aim for parks within a 2.5-minute walk of any other park in the city. We do not have that. And even the parks that we have sometimes are, like the new one right out here, has an awful lot of pavement in it. Pritchard Park has a lot of pavement in it. It seems to me when we have these trees already there, it's crazy to go to try to recreate a woodland somewhere else when you could have one that you've already got there. And so thank you for speaking tonight.
Mayor.
I agree with the points that have been made about how special this site can be with retention of the trees and making it public space. And as speakers were coming forward, I was reflecting back on my own experience. A couple of years before I ran for city council, involved with helping get an 11-acre tract along Hominy Creek in West Asheville acquired and included as part of the greenway system. And Councilman Pelley had a similar, I was thinking about you too, Chris, and in his neighborhood of Hall Creek, Chris helped lead a community group that ultimately was able to protect 10 acres of
9 acres
now called Masters Park, both of which were very much grassroots efforts. Just reflecting back on my experience with the Waller tract in West Asheville, that came forward as a proposal to city council and was denied 2 years prior to when we finally got it across the finish line. And what I came to realize is that, as I kind of helped champion that, was that the city leaders are not really in the best position to go out and raise money to get things done. And the advocates for that project, some of whom are here in this audience tonight, actually went out and found other money to bring to bear, so that the city actually ended up in a minority investment role, which made it affordable for the city. And affordability for the city and for our taxpayers is really important. We've got a lot of other priorities that really are stretching us now, it feels like, more than ever. So if reflecting in the bigger picture, the Waller tract, the city was into that for a third of the cost. The Masters Park, a third. Bowcatcher Overlook Park was initiated in the private sector. That was $1.5 million acquisition. A third of that was city investment. Carrier Park was largely donated land to the city. As a matter of fact, if you look throughout the River District, Riverlink has done a lot of fundraising and acquired certain parcels with 100% by funding 100% of the cost from other sources. And Pack Square Park, city was in for about 20% of the cost there. So to me, it seems important that we sort of move forward with expectations about how this might be done. Clearly, the developer agreeing to be patient while we sort through this. But I think that there's a great challenge to the grassroots organizers here to realize that there's a fundraising challenge here to get this done. I think I'm frankly not comfortable with the proposition that the city figure out how to fund all of it or 90% of it. This really needs to be a community effort, like many of the other great parks that we've been able to achieve. And so that would be the challenge I would offer up as a way to move forward here. So thank you, Mayor.
Go ahead. I have several questions. And thanks for being here tonight and coming like this. And I really appreciate the approach that you've taken and the civility with which you're approaching all of this. A few questions. Where is this in process right now as far as I understand it went to P&Z? Was it anywhere before that? What's the process this is taking?
You go ahead. Oh, I was looking for Alan.
I can speak to that, okay. Too. It was to go to before P&Z last week, and after meeting with the developer last week, they agreed to pull it.
Did it go anywhere before P&Z?
Downtown Commission.
It went to Downtown Commission. Did it go through the Tree Commission?
I think so.
Not that I'm aware.
It's been discussed there a couple of times now. And,
is there any recommendation that came from?
And the Tree Commission wrote a letter to in support of preserving the land.
Is that right?
The trees.
Okay, thank you. Is the developer present?
I spoke with him on the phone today. They're in Wilmington. They were not able to be here today.
Okay. I appreciate that y'all have all the answers to these questions. This is great. Steve brought forward was it the parks plan or the 2025 plan? I wasn't exactly clear.
The downtown master plan.
the downtown master planning process. So that piece is identified in that master plan, and so it led me to wonder, when we were establishing the innovation district for the South Slope and really looking for this high density, high return for the tax base sort of place, is this something that we missed, or was it considered, and was there something considered about it that we haven't looked at yet? So I don't expect an answer to that. We're going to have to go back into the notes to find that, but it's something I'm curious about is, when we were doing that innovation district, how did we examine this property? I want a kind of a staff perspective on that one, since they were doing the innovation districts. And just other questions. I'd like to know how much the developer paid for the acreage, what kinds of things he's looking at considering, a consideration of affordable housing, meaning what? I've been offered affordable housing before by developers, and that did not come to pass. So I'd like to learn a lot more here. I'm just real curious about what opportunities we may have.
I would also probably ask this of Chris, since you've been talking with the developer. Is there a time that these folks have put on this withdrawal?
That was a question I had for him today as well, too. And they're not committed to a specific time, but they're willing to let the process work for a little while. They're in the process of doing an appraisal of the current market value of the property. They expect that back in a couple weeks. They're prepared to share that with everyone once they get that back. As mentioned, their desire is to consider, for the city of Asheville, to consider a land swap with perhaps city-owned property downtown. They submitted some PIN numbers last week that they would like us to take a look at. That's their ideal scenario, but they're also open to just outright selling the land and perhaps even including taking a loss on a portion of that, and with the goal being to preserve the property there. And they did reiterate that they understand one of our strategic goals is creation of affordable housing, and without specifying what, they said they would be committed to including that into future development as well, too.
I would offer that without the developer really being in conversation with staff to bring this forward to know exactly the answer to some of those questions, we're pretty well groping right now. So I think as long as it's not, it's been pulled from P&Z and there's an ongoing dialogue, that staff should be involved with that, and then that gives us some better direction. Sitting here, I just don't know where to go with this right now.
Yeah, from my perspective, I think that would, because of the reasons you state there, a lack of information, from my perspective, a council nod towards staff to saying we would like you to initiate communication with the developer, or build on what's happened so far to see what's possible.
Have you heard enough verbal nods, Gary?
I've heard an interest in getting background and context from the parks plan, the downtown master plan, the economic development CIP, innovation district planning, make contact with the property owner, perhaps confirm some of the information that's already been provided on historical partnership agreements, and we can certainly put that information together, as well as confirm the status of the developer. Is that what I'm hearing? Certainly.
I would also, from my perspective, that can turn into a ton of work with that big open end. And much as we'd all like to say this could all happen, there's a lot of distance from here to here. And I know the staff's got just tons of stuff we've got up in the air right now. I would add to that within reason for the staff to have a meeting with this developer and see just how willing they really are and if there is a reason to carry forward with this consideration of exchange. That's pretty shaky stuff without them really being at the table.
Well, and I think the other important component is for the members of the public here tonight. Thank you. You've done great here tonight. You make a compelling case. But it's time to start getting pledges for financial commitments if you're going to be a partner in this, because we can't do it alone. We need you to be a partner in this here. And as you heard Vice Mayor Hunt say, in previous similar kind of transactions, the city came up with perhaps a third, and we're not committing to that tonight here, but be thinking in terms of at least an equal amount coming from the community as well, too. And once we have that appraisal back, we'll have a sense of what that number actually looks like as well, too.
Let me just expand just for a second on these previous successful park acquisitions and developments. In all cases, the projects were anticipated and conceptualized structurally before they came to the city with a request. So, you know, Bowcatcher Overlook Park was a project led by the Trust for Public Land, which is a nonprofit partner to park development efforts. It was conceptualized, fundraising was laid down, it was laid out to the city, look, we have an option to purchase this property, it's easy to follow through on, we've done title research, we've got a third of the money committed in fundraising, we're in conversation with other funding partners, and so on. And so by the time the city had something to look at, it was a conceptualized, formed up project that was ready to move forward. The proposition tonight so far has been, city, will you take this project and figure out how to do it? And my point earlier was, when it was laid out that way, the first time around with Hominy Creek Greenway, it did not occur. The second time around on Hominy Creek Greenway, the Waller Tract, the advocates took it and formed up the transaction, if you will, and invited the city to co-invest. So I think it's real important to understand that distinction about how project formation can happen and the way it happens successfully. As Jan points out, staff, our capacity at the city to do all the negotiations and due diligence to form up a project is very limited when it's not really certain whether fundraising will come true or get to the finish line. So I think there's an important role for the private sector, for advocates to play in helping shape this project to make it so that it can work for the city.
So I have learned that there are two other people that would like to speak not about this item and didn't realize that was the opportunity. So have we concluded this item? Yes.
Thank you all.
Okay, thank you. And if you'd like to speak on another item, that you are welcome to do that. Make way for one of our final two speakers there. Thank you. If you could just state your name, please.
It's Nick DiOrio. Ms. Mayor, council members, I belong to the Vietnam Veterans Association, Chapter 124 of Asheville. Thank you for giving us your time and opportunity to speak to you. I have talked to Tom Downing. I sent him information. I hope he passed that on to y'all. Do you know?
If you did, he did.
Okay. Well, anyway, we are bringing the Vietnam Traveling Memorial Wall to Asheville. As a matter of fact, it's now sitting in Swannanoa at the Harley-Davidson dealership. Okay? What the wall does, it offers some families a sort of closure for if they had not been able to go to D.C. to visit the real wall. For some of our Vietnam vets, they are old. I'm probably one of the younger ones. Okay? They are not able to go to D.C. to see the wall. So this offers them a chance to see a wall, reconnect with their buddies. It also gives us a chance to do some educating to the young people about this period of American history. We expect over 10,000 visitors to visit the wall. Among those visitors will be more than 12 schools, middle and high school. These students who are coming to see the wall is to correspond with their studies. One county middle school is bringing their entire eighth grade class. On that wall, there are 152 men from Western North Carolina who have their names on the wall again. We will have a field of crosses with 152 names on those walls for each member of our community who is on the face of that wall. We will have events every night starting at 7 p.m., September 9th through the 13th. Some of these events will include calling of the names of those on the wall, the laying of the wreaths by the Blue and Gold Star Mothers, Missing Man ceremony for over 2,000 MIAs, a patriotic ceremony honoring our first responders locally, flag retirement ceremony to educate the community how a flag is retired. There'll be a 21-gun salute from our honor guard. We have worked hard to raise over $13,000 to bring this to us. We have done poker runs. We have done bike nights. We went to the Apple Festival. We sent out letters to friends. We sent out letters to businesses. We have a 501c tax for businesses to use if they would like. It has been, and I emphasize, small business, the average citizen, who have helped us. We've gone to big business to ask for support, but we have been unable to get their support. We were hoping to not approach any area government for help. However, our budget calls for, I'm sorry, can I finish? It's just a little. It calls for $25,000. We went and saw Buncombe County. They have pledged to give us $6,000. That was the Buncombe County Commissioners. So tonight, we ask for your support with a donation to help us reach our budget. Thank you for taking your time to listen to us. And if there's any questions I can answer, I will be more than happy to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak? Mayor, I move that the Asheville City Council go into closed session for the following reasons. One, to prevent disclosure of information that is privileged and confidential pursuant to the laws of North Carolina or not considered a public record within the meaning of Chapter 132 of the General Statutes. The law that makes the information privileged and confidential is North Carolina General Statute 143-318.10.3. The statutory authorization is contained in North Carolina General Statutes 143-318.11A1. Two, to establish or to instruct the city staff or negotiating agents concerning the position to be taken by or on behalf of the city in negotiating the terms of a contract for the acquisition of real property by purchase, option, exchange, or lease. The statutory authorization is contained in North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11A5. And three, to consult with an attorney employed by the city about matters with respect to which the attorney-client privilege between the city and its attorney must be preserved. Statutory authorization is contained in North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11A3.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We will adjourn from the closed session.